Just a quick announcement before we actually start. I just want to remind people, you should all have received an email for reception tonight. So if you want to meet old friends or make new friends and a bunch of people from the community, you should come and have a drink with us. Everyone is invited. There'll be food, there'll be drinks, there'll be kegs of beers and good Tex-Mex food usually. It's going to be at the Enthought offices, which is downtown at 6th and Congress. And so there are buses that can take you there. There are taxis. There are all kinds of Uber replacements that can take you there. So feel free to come and have some food and meet people. I should have added a when, and it's from 6 to 9 tonight. Okay, so feel free to join us. Yeah, exactly. So it's like probably 15 minutes, something like this. Thank you for adding. There is a Slack channel for this tutorial, so I'm going to encourage you to leverage that. Yesterday I was in another tutorial, and it was actually really nice because some people who had issues could post on Slack during the tutorial and get them resolved faster than interrupting me and moving around the room. Are you going to stay with me, or are you sneaking out? That's fine. So if Ben is around, Ben can also help you guys. If not, this is a beginner session, so I want to insist on the fact that beginners are welcome here, and you should not worry about having a stupid question or anything. The goal is for you to get started with pandas. So ask questions, ask them on Slack, and then make me pause if I need to, okay? Together this afternoon, we're going to learn to analyze and manipulate data sets, and we'll do that with pandas mostly. Because it was a beginner tutorial, I was trying to restrict myself to just one package mostly and not start taking you in all kinds of directions. It's hard to do that with pandas because there is a big ecosystem around pandas, and so you want to, as soon as you start playing with it, you want to leverage other things. But we're going to focus on pandas. I want to give you the basics. I want everyone to be comfortable with that. I see some familiar faces in the audience, so it means that some of you are advanced Python, pandas users already, most probably. So you're not here for nothing. There is more material than I can cover in 4 hours, so hopefully you'll find a few things that are interesting. And in any case, I'm also happy to enroll you to help other people in the room and respond to questions. So my name is Jonathan. You can reach me on, I'm trying to become a Twitter user, me too. So you can reach me on Twitter or shoot me an email or something. I used to work at Enthought, the organizer of, or the, I guess, institutional sponsor of this conference. And I now work at a biopharmaceutical company called KBI Biopharma. That's all that to say that I've been using Python for a few years now, about 6 years. And while in my previous life at Enthought, I was also teaching Python, and so I enjoy teaching. I want everyone to come out of here knowing a lot more than they had coming in. So please ask questions. When I teach, I always like to say that this tutorial is going to be as good as the number of questions you ask. Okay, so feel free to do that. I want to give a few thanks. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to give this tutorial. Initially, it was slated to be given by Jeff Reback, the maintainer of pandas, and I was actually looking forward to his tutorial. And unfortunately, he had to cancel his attendance, so I'm going to do my best to replace him, even though I'm not a core developer of pandas. So I'm going to give you my take on how to learn pandas the most effectively and how to use it for your day-to-day work. I also thank my employer, KBI, and I also want to thank Enthought, because some of the material you are seeing this afternoon was developed while I was working there. And so I want to acknowledge their support. What is pandas? As you probably all have heard of it. If not, you probably would not have signed up for this tutorial. But just a few facts, a few dates, a few numbers, I guess. It was started by Wes McKinney around 2009. I remember some good conversations back then at the AnThought offices around, you know, we need a new data structure. We need something that can store our data and that knows more about the data than a NumPy array. Most probably all of you are familiar with NumPy. Hopefully, if you were not familiar with NumPy, you went to the tutorial yesterday on NumPy. And this package Panda is all built on top of NumPy and tries to bring lots of information about the NumPy array and lots of tools right there inside the data structure or inside the package for you to be able to be working at a higher level and do your data work faster. So it emerged from the finance industry and quickly became something that was very valuable to many, many different industries. And it is now one of the most central packages of the Python or scientific Python ecosystem, just like Pandas is. And so you'll, some of you who are beginners are going to wonder, when should I use Pandas and when should I use NumPy? So the short answer to that would be, if you have to have a lot of control over your data, how much memory is being used, maybe because you're using you are manipulating a lot of data, I would recommend to use NumPy. And as soon as the amount of data is not dramatically ginormous, then Pandas is easier to get things done. Okay, that would be my 3 minute or 1 minute recommendation. Okay, so the concepts, all the concepts in Pandas were in another very good language for doing statistics called R, and therefore a lot of the inspiration, a lot of the names came from that world, and in particular that data frame concept that R had and that Wes really wanted to be able to enjoy from Python. So he would be switching over back and forth, and Python being a better language, everybody knows that. He wanted to have a data frame in Python. So he started writing that and then started gathering a large crowd of the community behind him. First release was made around early 2011. And since then, it has been growing very, very quickly. It has been the single most appealing package, bringing a lot of people from other languages to Python. So we can help. We can thank Wes and Pandas for growing our community. And whenever I went on GitHub to see how many contributors there were to Pandas, and GitHub showing me the contributors said, "Wow, that's a big list." So it's really a big community now. A lot of people contributing to it, reporting bugs, writing code for it. The latest release was made May of this year. It's open source. It's BSD. Means you can do anything you want with it. It's free to use. It's also free to make products and make money off of it. So, have at it. So the mission of the package, at least as I understand it, I guess the first quote is actually taken from the official documentation of Pandas, and the mission is to provide a high performance, easy to use data structure. And data analysis tools, of course, in Python. Okay, so my translation of that is that you end up with easy to use. I'm putting this easy to use first. Actually, I feel like high performance is also true, but I feel like really where Pandas shine is by how easy it is to do things, to get things done. So. I was talking about the fact that people needed to go beyond the NumPy array and have something, some data structure that describes the data a little bit more than having to index into something with zeros and ones and numbers. So you have data structures that describe themselves and that are therefore easier to explore, to clean, to understand. You have data loaders to and from various file formats, SAS, SQL, HDF5, CSV, Excel, you name it. There are many more. They are plotting functions that are right there. If you have an object from Pandas, you can just ask itself to plot itself and it will just bring you a plot without having to learn much of Matplotlib, at least at the beginning. And if you want more, I'll mention a few more names from the ecosystem around pandas. And then there are some basic statistical tools as well in the pandas package, even is accessible within the from within the data structure. And again, if you want more, if you want to do more, more modeling, you'll have to at some point wander outside of pandas and go explore what's in stats models and potentially scikit-learn if you want to do machine learning on your data. So I made this slide just a few days ago, and I had a few names in my head of packages that really are designed to work really nicely with data frames. And as I was doing a little bit of research, and I was discovering all kinds of packages that I haven't had initially a chance to use, but this this ecosystem around the around this pandas packages has grown quite a bit over the past few years because of how central and how useful pandas is. Okay, so I'll mention a few packages, scikit-learn pandas to help you leverage scikit-learn stats models. I've just mentioned it. X-Array is has the ability, you have the ability to transform data structures from X-Array to pandas and vice versa. Same for Dask. X-Array being more if you're working not so much with time series or financial data, but more with XYZ data, raster data, and so on. So it has a little bit of more of a democratic approach than pandas does. Dask is going to be your go-to package. It has grown. It's still very young, but it has grown and is becoming really impressive for doing calculations that are out of core, meaning you leave your data on disk and you compute with them as if it was in memory, but you have too much of it. It's also a really nice tool for doing parallel computation if you have your data in pandas. There are other packages. I'm going to mention GeoPandas for, again, people working with spatial aware data. And then there is a very big space for packages helping or providing high-level tools for plotting these data sets. The nice thing about pandas data frames and data structures is that the data structure knows a lot about what it is, what it represents, and therefore lots of packages can make beautiful plots right away out of the box just because it can ask the data structure, what do you, what are you about, what kind of data is X, what kind of data is Y. So I'm going to mention Seaborn that I think is really awesome for making plots, visualization, even really more exploration plots without any calculation. I'm going to mention Bokeh if you want to do plots targeting a web browser. I'm going to mention Plotly in that same space for making very very nice plot, and Vincent and Altair also. I'm going to mention also some of the packages that nthought puts out if you want to embed your pandas data frame into a graphical user interface. I'll mention TraceUI, for example, for providing the ability to expose that to a user. So what are we going to do today? I want to use a quote by Jack van der Plas, who's a very prominent person in this community. He had a tweet recently that got a lot of likes, and I liked it too. And so this tutorial is humbly trying to tackle the first 90% of your work. The bad news is that there is a second 90%. So I'm only going to tackle the first 90% of the work, which is to clean your data. And really, when you get your data, you have to work. It's pretty realistic, at least for some of you, I hope, that you spend 90% of your time cleaning it up so that you can finally visualize it. And then it hopefully is not too hard to model, and then it can be pretty hard to interpret depending on your situation. So we'll tackle these 90%. We're ambitious here. And so to learn pandas, I used to teach pandas using slides actually, and I felt like it was it was not really conveying the power of this package, because you're just showing you data structures and making a list of all the attributes and methods is not a good way to teach this package in particular. And so we're going to go through a notebook. In fact, it's going to be two different notebooks. Reminder that you need to do a git pull if you haven't done so while coming in this room, because now there are two notebooks. Until yesterday night, there was only one notebook, and it was too big. So we're going to take an excuse, still the goal being pandas, but we're going to take the excuse of exploring some climate data. And my goal with this notebook or with this data exploration is to show you that we can become better citizens if we use some of the tools we have access to. Everything is free that we're using and open source, and including the data that we're going to play with, and that allows us to potentially have better debates about topics sometimes. So we'll play with temperature data, we'll play with sea level data. If you do the exercises, you'll play with the greenhouse gas data, and then we'll see what we can figure out. Full disclosure, I'm not a climate scientist. Ben is a lot more of a climate scientist. I know. That's why I said a lot more of a climate scientist. So full disclosure, I am not pretending that you're going to learn anything useful about climate. We're just going to play with the data from that world. And if you are and you want to give me some ideas of what to do with these data sets, I'm very interested. Okay, so let's stop these slides and let's get to work. All right, so you should all be able to fire up a Jupyter notebook. And so can you guys see my screen here? So if you are all set, you should have inside the folder that you got from the Git clone, you should get a climate time series folder, which is where we're going to spend all the rest of this tutorial. You should have a PDF of the slides I just showed. So if you go inside this climate time series, excuse me, and you do an LS, you should see two IPython notebooks in there. You should see also a data folder. Okay. So let's fire up the first IPython notebook. Jupyter notebook. All right. So, by the way, I gave a tutorial very, very similar to this one last year, which was also recorded. You can find it on YouTube. So if at some point you will, I'm not clear in this one, you can go check if last year I explained things better. So the story here is that it's always interesting to live in Texas. You never have to go very far to find people with different opinions. And in particular, if you want to talk about climate, there are always interesting debates to have. So that's what I want to do with this notebook, is to show how simple it is to go and get your data yourself, clean it up, visualize it, and then decide what you think about any problem. Okay, so I got the inspiration looking at the International Panel for Climate Change, looking at what kind of data they were doing. Again, full disclosure, I don't have the background to understand all their studies, so I just really got just an inspiration. And the idea was to go and get let me make a little bit more room, toggle header, toggle toolbar. So maybe I can even do this. All right. So I went out and got some data sets, and here is what I wanted us to learn to do with these data sets. So we'll have two parts in this analysis. A part one where I tried to put myself in your shoes, and I tried to think about what kind of workflow you were going to go through with your own data. Okay, so I'm assuming that the first step for everyone is to load the data into something. So that's the first step that we're going to take. And then we'll learn a little bit about what is this something that we got once we loaded the data. And then we'll learn to clean and format the data, because until you clean it and you format it decently, there is no way to even plot it. Hey, Ben? Ben? Sorry, do you want to give maybe a little bit of help? Thank you, Ben. You good? So, all right. So once the data is cleaned up, we'll be able to visualize it. I'll show you how easy it is to visualize it, and then we'll switch over to the second notebook. We will have learned. We will have spent a fair amount of time on this part one because of those 90% that I was talking about earlier. And so once we have cleaned up our data and we know we can visualize it, it's going to be time to learn to store it back to disk so that we don't waste all this effort. So we'll learn to load on section one and to save back to disk at the end of this first part. And then second part, we'll load back up our data. And we'll learn to explore our data, to access our data, to query our data. We'll learn to work with the dates and times, because I'm assuming that many of you are working with time series. We'll learn to transform our data sets. We'll learn to do some, I'll show you what I mean by transform, but basically we will want to transform our data set in completely customized, a potentially completely customized way. We'll learn to do that in section eight. Then, if we have time, we'll have section 8, 9, 10, and 11. I'm gonna call them optional, even though I believe that they have lots of interesting content, because what I have in front of you in these two notebooks is more than can be covered in 4 hours. But so we'll go as far as we can to learn to do some statistical analysis. We should be able to get to that. Data aggregation, data summarization. Some of you who've worked with Excel and like that pivot table button in Excel will learn to do that in Pandas. We'll learn to do some group by that you may enjoy from the SQL world and these kinds of things, okay? And then the cherry on top will be these last two sections, learning to compute some correlations, learning to do some linear regressions between the data sets we have, and potentially learning to do some predictions. And the general thread I'm going to have is I want to know how correlated the temperature and the sea level data that we have is. I would like to be able to make some predictions. So again, with no climate science background, but I'd like to make some predictions, and kind of my final goal, if you get to it, most probably on your own, because we won't have time to go all the way to the end, would be, is New York going to flood at the end of the century? Okay, so that's really what I want to know. I don't want to, you know, tell any secrets, but the plots we make at the end are not necessarily happy. All right, so let's get started. Before we get started, and so that I know what pace I should be going at, I wanna do a show of hands. How many people have been coding in Python for less than a year? All right, a small half. How many people have done I've coded in Python for more than a year and less than 3 years, let's say, about the rest, okay? How many people have coded in Python for more than 5 years? All right, I count on you guys to help others during exercises, and if you learn something, I'll be very happy. All right, so let's get started. So I'm going to import a few things in this first cell. I'm going to import matplotlib. I have said that pandas carries within itself a lot of the tools that we'll need even for doing plotting, but under the covers, pandas delegates to a lot of other packages, and the package that it delegates to for doing the plotting internally is called matplotlib. So that's the that's a package that, if you know a little bit of it, it's going to be useful for you to augment what pandas gives you in terms of plots. And in any case, matplotlib also controls or can allow you to control where we're going to plot things. So this first command, matplotlib inline, is going to allow me to make all my plots or build all my plots within the notebook so that I don't have to fight with multiple windows. But if you wanted to, you could have separate windows. So I'm gonna, if you run this, you'll have all of your plots within the thing, within the notebook. So it's gonna be useful. I'm gonna import pandas as PD, which is a common practice. So that means that everything within the notebook that starts with PD dot is going to be something that we're learning about from the pandas library, and that's the goal of this tutorial. I also mentioned already that pandas uses NumPy under the covers for storing its data and for doing a lot of its operations. And because of that, some of the operations that we will want to use are not redefined in pandas, and we'll need to go and grab them directly in NumPy. Okay, so that's going to be our foundation layer. If you're comfortable with NumPy, you're going to understand more of this tutorial and more of what pandas does, or you'll be able to guess more of what pandas does. But if you don't, if you're not too familiar with NumPy, that's okay. Think of it as a low-level library of fundamental tools. So I'm going to import it as np. I'm going to import matplotlib again to augment a little bit the plots that we'll make. The first thing I'm going to teach you about pandas is to control how data frames look like. Okay, so there is nothing more frustrating than using a package that's supposed to help you to wrap your head around data sets, and it shows up and it says just a summary: this is a data set with that many rows and that many columns. Okay, so you can control how pandas is going to represent all of its data structures with this set option. So I recommend that you go and explore it. I gave one example of a command you can use. For example, you can control how many rows you want to see in a data frame as a preview. By default, it's going to be 20, if I recall correctly. At least that's last time I checked. And because I'm on a small screen, I'm reducing this. But it's really mostly to point you to this function, set option, so that you can control things. Okay, you can control how many rows before you have this little ellipsis and you don't see the rest. Okay, that can be something that's really useful. I'm also going to define, because we're going to make lots of plots, and some of them will have a lot of data on them, I'm also defining a tuple here, 12.8, to control the size of my matplotlib figures. All right, so second cell, so shift enter in the cell, I'm assuming. How many people are new to this notebook thing? Okay, a few, so you know, ask if you need help. But the idea is that once you have opened a so two things then for you guys. Once you have a cell, you'll want to run shift enter to run that cell, to execute that cell. And then another thing that's going to be useful, I'm going to bring back my toolbar. Another thing that's going to be useful, once you're in a cell, if you want to, the whole point of this notebook is that it allows you to create other cells, insert other cells. So I just clicked on this little plus button here. It allows me to create another cell. It allows you to create another cell and to experiment. I said, for example, that pd.setOption was a good function. So it should make you want to stop looking at me for a second and go, okay, pd.setOption. So how am I supposed to use this guy? So you can do a question mark and shift enter again, and you can get the documentation for this set option, okay? So I highly encourage you, that's again why I'm teaching this with a notebook rather than with slides, is to allow you to learn something, see something that's useful, insert a cell and start exploring on your own while we're doing things, okay? So please go ahead and do that. Whenever you want. So the next cell is going to be something that you'll have to contribute, because I don't know where you've put your data, okay? So the goal is for us to go into the folder that contains your data so that we can start loading all the data that I gave you. So this path here is gonna work only on my laptop, and actually I just moved the folder, so it's not even gonna work for me either. So you should take your IPython prompt or your Jupyter notebook to the right location to find the data. If you've done a good job, when you do a %ls, you should see a data folder. Okay, so go ahead. You can use tab completion, and I'm going to do the same here. So for me, it's going to be inside my home directory, and then project, and then SciPy 2016, and then pandas tutorial. Okay, so. So go ahead and update that cell. You should, at the end, when you do a %ls and you see the content of wherever you are, you should see this this data folder that I don't see. Oh, yeah, it's not good. I need to also do climate time series. All right, so now I'm good. Okay, you're all good? Everybody found their data? All right, let's go. By the way, if you are curious about where this data is, there is a README in the data folder, which is lacking a little bit of details, but you have a little bit more about the sources. I'll update it, actually, because I want you guys to know what you're looking at. All right, so the first thing we're going to learn, we said, was to load some data. So one thing that's really nice about an IPython prompt or an IPython notebook or a Jupyter notebook, all these things are very, very closely related, is the ability to do tab completion. Okay, so if you do pandas dots and then read underscore and you hit your tab key, you should see a bunch of different options. Okay, and that's going to give you all the options that Panda offer you to load some data into a pandas data structure. For example, you could copy to your clipboard, you could copy some data that you're finding on the web, that you're finding in a document, and you could say pandas.readClipboard, and you should be able to get, in many situations in any case, you should be able to get a nice data frame out of your clipboard, which is pretty nice. More realistically, you're going to be working with CSV files, you're going to be working with Excel files, you're going to be working with HDF5 files. Maybe you'll have downloaded a web page and you'll have an HTML file with some data in there. Maybe you have some data that was given to you in JSON, and so on and so forth. There is the big Google BigQuery format. There are lots of different formats that pandas support, and they are adding and improving them all the time. It's a very, very active project. Some of you might be working with SAS files, SQL tables, and so on and so forth, okay? And the first one that we're going to learn about is the last one, called read table, and this is going to be the one that allows you to load some data from a text file, okay? So as soon as we find a function that looks useful, we should do a question mark on it to see how we're supposed to use this guy. And that's a little bit scary to do that when you are looking at the read table, because there are quite a few options, okay? So pandas is trying to be very easy to use, and that means giving you a lot of options, because God knows how complicated your data set or your data file can be. And so you have a lot of options in there. And if you look closely, actually, all of these options have default values. So you don't really necessarily have to worry too much at first. You can just say, OK, which ones are the arguments that I have to provide? It's just the first one, the file path. Okay. Everything else is an option. And it's pretty safe to assume at first that all the default values might, if you're lucky, might be good enough for you. Okay, so I'm going to load the first file with read table. I'm just going to pass the name of the file. I'm going to cross my fingers and hope it doesn't crash. Okay, that's a good programming technique. Before we do this, I want to show you the file that we're loading. Okay, so I'm going to go into my data in there. You don't have to do this. I just want to show you. So I'm going to go into the temperatures, and the first one that we're going to load is this this file. So this file, annual land ocean 90 south to 90 north data frame from 1901 to 2000. So it's a century of data, and so if you look at it, oh no, that's not what I want. I'm going to open it with something else. Let's say I open it with Canopy. I'm also going to open the second file so that we can look at both. Well, we will be loading both files. All right, what's going on? All right, so this is the data that we're going to load. Okay, we're going to start easy, and we're going to get to more complicated files afterward. So for now, I just have a DAT file. Everybody has seen those, and it has temperature data across the globe. So the average temperature data across the globe for the past 120 years, something like this. Okay, this data, in case you're wondering, is coming from the NOAA website. And these values don't really look like temperatures, but they are temperature differences. Climate scientists like to store their data in temperature differences. So they'll calculate a temperature around the 70s, an average temperature of the globe of around the 70s. And so they'll display the global Earth temperature as a difference to that reference point. Okay, so if it's cold, it means that the value is negative, and if it's warmer, it means that the value is positive, okay? So we want to load this guy. And I also wanted to load this the second guy, and so we're going to load this one afterward, okay? So that might look more like the kinds of files you have to fight with every day. All right. So like I said, we can hope for the best. So that's what I'm going to do here. I'm going to pass the path of the file, and then I'm going to give it to read table and see what I got. Okay. And the good news is that we got something. It didn't crash. So we must be good programmers. The bad thing is the other nice thing is that we got a nice table. Okay. So that's a nice thing that the notebook does, is to render these tables nicely for us. The bad thing is that there are a few things that we would want to improve, okay? Because these dates, for example, they were supposed to describe the value. So so here we have an object that has what we call an index in pandas, which is referencing the values, and that's what I meant by self-describing. The problem is that right now the values that we're using to self-describe, they are uninteresting. They are just counting the rows, and so we would want to use those years to count the rows. What else is problematic about this? Yeah, everything is in one field. Very good. It didn't realize that that these were two different values. So we have only one column. What else? Yeah, the column headers, they're completely messed up. My column name right now is 1880, and then I'm losing some data and stuff like that. Okay, so we do have to look at all the options that read table is giving us. We can even hope for the first options at the beginning of the list to be maybe the ones that are most commonly used. That's also a reasonable assumption to make. And then, so we'll want to control the name of our columns, and then we'll potentially want to control the which column is the index. So let's do that together, okay? So if I go back to my question mark, okay, so my second parameter is called sep, okay? The separator between the values, and those separators are assumed to be tab, okay? So it works great for a tab delimited file, but if we have a space delimited file, that doesn't work, okay? So we're gonna have to override the sep, and then for the, we'll work also on some of the other options. We have options to skip some rows. We have options to skip some footers. If we had some like blob of text at the top or blob of text at the bottom, we're going to work on using some of these options later. For now, we'll just keep things simple. And for now, I'm just going to make sure that when I have two values, I really get two values. Okay, so. I'm going to specify a separator, and I want to specify as my separator any number of spaces, okay? That's what our file is. It has a couple of spaces in between. And so if you're comfortable with regular expressions, you're very comfortable with this backslash s plus notation. If you're not comfortable with regular expressions, that's okay. This is the only place where we're going to talk about regular expressions here. But just you can just learn that backslash s means a space, any kind of space, okay? And plus means any number of those, okay? So backslash s plus means any number of spaces. All right. So if I do if I specify just this separator, now I get two different columns. So I've definitely made some progress. I still have my header issue. And so I'm going to pass the name of the columns manually, okay? And the names option allows me to do this, okay? So I would like the first column to be called year, the second column to be called min temp, or I guess it could be called temp difference. And now I'm getting a lot closer to having an object that captures my data for real, okay? Was hopefully not a whole lot of work. Good question, thank you. And then the last thing I said that was not very nice was that I had not specified any index column, and so pandas by default is going to create an index for me, okay? So if I have to index all my data, indexing meaning accessing, if I have to access all my data with 0, 1, 2, 3, I haven't gained anything compared to a NumPy array. If I have a NumPy array, I have to do that, just like a Python list, index element number 0, okay? That's not great. And so I want to specify that my column index is the number 0. Do you have a question? You're good? All right. So if I specify that my column 0 is my index, yes. For the years? Yeah. So it's okay. It used to not be okay, actually, a long time ago, but now it's okay. Obviously, if you don't specify an index, it doesn't matter because it's going to create a unique, kind of like SQL would do that for a table, right? But even if you specify an index column like this, it's going to be fine. I'll come back to that when we talk about indexing because, you know, I mean, it's going to create the index, it's fine, but now what happens if you ask for that year? What do you get? Okay. If you ask for any normal year, you'll get one value. If you ask for that year that has multiple entries, you'll get multiple values. You'll get a sub-series. This is called a series. Actually, I lied. This is not a series. We'll come back to that. All right. And yes. No, good question too. No, it's nothing to be concerned about. It was not like that, right? It was year and mean temp next to each other, and then once I say the year is actually the index, now it's not anymore. Okay, and so that just is just IPython's Jupyter's representation of a table, just to show you that year now is not a column anymore. It's the name of my index. is the name of the things I'm going to use to access the data. It's not a regular column, okay? So if I ask for the list of columns of that object, we'll see we only have one column, is the mean temp, okay? We can go back and forth between the two views. I'll show that. Then the last thing the last option I'm gonna advertise for is this parse dates. Do you have a question too? Or an installation issue maybe over there? Ben, over there. Thank you. Thank you, Ben, so much. the last thing that I'm gonna show you is this parse dates. If you look at all the options, you're going to find that one cool, especially if you have time series. And so you can try to use it. So I want to show you a couple ways of we'll do that in an exercise too. If you say parse dates equals true, it's going to try to convert your index, only your index, as a date. Okay? So parse dates equal true. If I run this guy, now you see that my year column, my year used to be 1880, and now it's 1880 January 1st at midnight. Okay, so it's clearly understanding these numbers, or actually parsing these numbers as dates. Okay, so that's going to be useful. We'll come back to this point. Okay, and so I'm going to call it good enough. I'm going to say that, you know, one step at a time, I got to something that I'm finding decent. So I'm going to make a little cheat sheet here. This is my first data set. We're going to be working with, at times, a little bit more, but usually it's going to be mostly two data sets, or three data sets, I guess. And so that's one of them, okay? So it's the NOAA data set, okay? And I'm calling it full globe temp, okay? And this guy is just it's mostly a one-dimensional data set, although right now it's not quite a one-dimensional data set, okay? So this is my NOAA temperature data. And for now, I'm going to say this is good enough. And I want to switch over to a harder file. So let me bring back this. Yeah. Yeah, one person. You should tell us. That's why we're here. Yeah, it's going to be 4 hours of me talking. It's going to be completely uninteresting. So one lady here. It was three down. Do you have an issue too? No. All right, so I'm going to continue, and then we're getting close to an exercise, so you have to follow because you'll have a test pretty soon. All right, so I wanted to load that second data set, and the second data set was going to look a lot more messy, and actually with my tiny screen here, it's even messier. But if you look at it closely here, this is pretty messed up, okay? This comes from NASA. You can always count on NASA to give you... I don't know why I'm saying that. It's just... Anyway, so it was a great, so all this is true story, right? I really just went out and downloaded the files. I didn't doctor anything. I didn't clean up anything. So it's full true story. I thought this data set was great, but it's really messy. It gives me a great teaching experience, or you. All right, so I have some stuff at the top, okay? Remember, we had those skip rows. It's probably going to be useful here. We had that skip rows option. I also have some stuff at the bottom as well, okay? So I'm gonna have to use that skip footer option that we saw earlier, okay? It's still a text file, so there is still this data set, this read table is still gonna work, but we're gonna have to use a few more options. If I look at the number of characters in between these numbers, these are spaces, okay? So the separator needs to be tweaked as well with that backslash S plus. And then I have some headers here, so maybe this time Panda is gonna be happy with me and just infer the header from that row here. So as long as I skip the first seven rows, I don't want to skip the row number 8 because I want pandas to infer the name of my columns from it, okay? So I'm going to keep that. I'm going to skip 7 rows. I'm going to skip 11 footers. I counted for you. And we'll see what happens. All right, so here it is. Skip row 7, skip footer 11. This engine equals Python here, you don't have to put it, but if you don't put it, you'll have a little a warning, okay? And the warning, especially if you're new to Python, warnings always look like, you know, Chinese if you don't speak Chinese or something. So I want to translate this one at least. So engine equals Python here means that, read table, I guess, has two different engines. There is a fast engine and there is a flexible engine. There is an engine written in C. There is an engine written in Python. The fast one's going to be obviously the C. The more flexible one's going to be the one in Python. And in this one, I'm using one option that the C engine doesn't support, which is the skip footer here. So I have to do, I have to say engine equals Python, or it's going to say, sorry, but I don't, I can't use the default engine, which is the C one, because of that skip footer, all right? So I'm going to load that. I'm going to use just these few options, and then I get something. So that's pretty good. If I had just done read table with no option, it would not have worked. All right, so I can look at my table, and I'm noticing that there is some stuff in it that's clearly not going to be useful. Okay, so this seems to be a repeat of the column names. Yes. 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 Yeah, you should have it too, right? It's the same. By the way, if in case you are experimenting with these notebooks and in case you are afraid to break them and not be able to follow anymore, I recommend that you make a copy of these notebooks real quick. You go to File, make a copy, and then you have like a backup of these notebooks in case you break it. Then you don't have to worry about you don't have to worry about experimenting with them, and if you break them, you load the other one and you continue, okay? All right, so it seems like we still got some junk in there. We also got an index auto-generated with numbers, which was not very useful. It would have been nicer if the year column here was specified as our index. So we can improve that a little bit. And we'll do that. So we can improve that a little bit by using more of the reading function options. But we can also clean things up after the fact. Okay. So this previous file, I made it completely clean right at the load step. This one, I'm going to keep it a little bit messy like this, and I'm going to clean it up afterward while working on this object since I got an object. Okay. So so here is your test. You have a little exercise. You're welcome to experiment with a little quiz here by taking some options out and seeing what happens. So you're welcome to do this. And then I'm going to give you, let's say, 5 minutes to try and read another file in that data folder, in the greenhouse gas folder. There is something called CO2 millimeter global. So go ahead and try to read this guy. Okay? I'm going to give you, yes. Five minutes to do this.
It's a question about reading files. I saw that there's a read CSV method and a read table.
Yes.
What's the difference between read CSV with comma delimiter and read table with comma delimiter and read CSV? Like, why would you
good. Good question. So the read CSV is going to use the CSV package for dealing with CSVs. So the easiest, if you have a very well behaved CSV file with only commas in between the fields, the read table sep equals comma is going to be perfect. If you have these weird CSVs with quotes and all the complicated CSV options that you can have in a CSV, you'll want to use the read CSV. You'll have access to more of the fancy options.
Okay.
You're welcome. Yes. All right, so the file we're trying to load is this one. I have a year column, I have a month column, and then I have a decimal version of that year month. And then I have an average CO2, and then I have a trend. Okay, so would be good to load all of this. That's your first step. And then once you're done with loading all this just the way it is, then I would like you to try and make the index by parsing both columns, both first columns. Okay, so bonus question here. If you've loaded the file, try to load it again and making the index as the first two columns parsed as a date. Okay? Hint, parse dates option is useful.
How close should it be?
I can adjust the level.
Okay.
And that
Thank
way,
you.
Yeah. Worry about that.
Yeah, that's cool. Thanks.
I was kind of seeing if I was going to just take one projected screen.
Okay. I'll try to do
when
this.
When you point it one on the
Gotcha.
It'll look like you're pointing at the
Got
side.
It.
Thank
Thanks.
You.
I'm going to try this all the time.
Thank you.
You guys still hear me? Kind of. No?
Hello?
Okay. How about like this? Still not. They can't hear me. What about like this? All right, don't worry, it's okay. Yeah, exactly. I'll just hold it for now. Okay. Yeah, no, I don't want to do this. All right, so read table is useful probably. And we said parse dates is useful also. So let's. How many people finished the exercise, including the bonus question? That's awesome. It's too late. You've said yes already. It was oral, the bonus question. So great if you got the data back. Okay, if you got the data up, we're going to be learning how to work with the data set and convert things to date times after the fact and everything. So if you loaded the file, congrats. If you were able to figure out that extra bonus question, double congrats. And if not, we'll do it together. Okay. So we said we would load the file. So we just need to call read table again, and we need to pass the file. And that, as usual, doesn't work. It kind of works, but kind of not. So how about the separator, just like before? Okay, now I have pretty much done my job. Okay, if I didn't want to figure out the combining the year month together, I could just decide that my index could be the decimal column. Okay, so I could count 0, 1, 2. So if I do index col equals 2, I'm going to have something that's pretty decent. Okay, I am indexing my data. The problem is that I'm indexing my data with
with decimal values, so it's not that great. Okay, so I don't want to do this. So instead, I said the parse dates might be useful. And so so let's put a question mark and go and read the question, and then. So if you look at this, you can go look at how parse dates work. I have very little space in here. And so the parse dates, you see it here. So the parse dates is pretty extensive, the number of things you can do. You can just put a Boolean value, true or false, and it's going to parse the index. But you can also, so otherwise you could also provide a list of column numbers, and it will parse each of these columns as dates, okay? And then the third option is the one we wanted here. The third possibility is to give to parse dates a list of lists and say, for example, in this case, combine column 1 and 3 as a date. Okay, so let's try that. So I'm going to say parse dates equals, and I would like column 0 and 1. And so I'll have to have a list of lists. Okay? And so I'm gonna remove this guy. And so now I have this new column here. Year month. The name of that column was generated automatically. But that's okay. We can change that later. And these are dates. And so now the last final thing that would be nice would be to say index col equals 0. And that should do the right thing, okay? It's kind of, once they have been combined, it's treated as column number 0. Together, these two columns have been fused into one column. And so it's treated at column 0. So that's why this index col equals 0 still works. Okay, yes. No, it doesn't matter. That's a Python thing. Keyword arguments can be provided in any order. So but it's a good question, and I see where you're coming from. So you're like, you know, what if it does the indexing, specifying the index first and then parsing, you know, and the answer is you would have to look at the source code to know what they do, because Pandas is gonna get all that information together in a dictionary. There is no order in a dictionary. There was another question, yes? Yes. So if you were in that situation, what I would do is I would just worry about parsing the dates together, and I would worry about setting the index afterward. We'll learn to do that after the fact. I wouldn't try to do everything in the loading step. There was another question. Okay, awesome. Yes, question? Yeah. Yeah. So the answer is it can be done. In Python, everything can be done. But afterward, the next question is it? So no, not while loading. We'll see in a second that these things are date objects. They are not strings. So you have to think of these are objects that know about date and time. And their representation, their string representation, is a separate problem. Okay, so if you wanted to represent them differently, you could make another column with strings in it. But really, fundamentally, what you care about is the knowledge of the date and the time, not its representation. So now we have something. Now that it's parsed with dates, we have these things. They are timestamps. They are objects that know when they are in time, and so you can compare them to other times. Okay, we'll learn to do that later. All right. So if you have this guy written down, you'll be able to continue playing with this data set as we learn about others. But the rest of the notebook's not going to use them unless you want to do it. All right, so we're going to do something a little bit more fun. Not everything is local. Some files are remote, and Pandas is going to go and fetch them for you remotely. How nice. So this read table here, so it's amazingly simple, right? And that's why I want everybody to become a better citizen and better informed. You can specify the URL. So for example, the University of Colorado is kindly publishing some data, constantly publishing some data about the sea level. I was browsing around and to find these, and if I go to this URL, let me actually take you there. So we're all going together. So anyway, Wi-Fi is pretty good here. So if we all go together, you'll see that this URL is actually a text file. It's just that it's a remote text file. Okay, so there is nothing mysterious about it. It's just posted somewhere. So a text file, if it was local, we would use read table. The nice thing is that since it is a text file, I'm still going to use read table and provide the URL for it. Okay, so I have a column of years. And I have this measurement of the sea level compared to some average, most probably. And so I'm just going to do exactly the same, and I'm going to load this data set. So you see my little star here. Go ahead and run it as well, by the way, so that we all collide on the we create a denial of service attack on the University of Colorado. So you see that other than the file path being a URL, we have we've just done the same thing, and we now have the local file. We have the local data set. We don't have a file. Nothing was put on your disk. It was just loaded into memory. Okay. If you look closely, you'll see that this is the sea level SL and then NH for Northern Hemisphere. Actually, they're giving us the data in Northern Hemisphere, Southern Hemisphere, and globally. So I'm going to load all three of them, and then we'll learn to combine all these data sets together to work with them together. Okay? So I'm going to grab also, so shift run, you don't have to work hard, and then I'm going to do shift run for the next one. I'm going to grab the Northern Hemisphere, Southern Hemisphere, and the global data sets. The nice thing about this is that somebody else must be using the Wi-Fi. The nice thing about this, we're really getting data that was taken this month. Okay, so it's nice, nice data and recent data. Okay, and if you look, we got three columns. Do you understand why we got three columns? There seem to only be two columns in this file, but yeah. So what happens that Pandas is looking at the first row to infer the number of columns. Okay, in the first row, it's finding three strings, and so it's saying, oh, there must be three columns. So it's creating a table with three columns, and then every single row afterward, it's not finding any data, and so what it's doing for us is that it's saying, oh, I don't have a number for this column. Okay, so we'll learn to throw that column away. It's not interesting. Okay, what we care about is that middle column for the values, and then this would be great to have that as an index. What time is it, by the way? 2:45. Okay, so we'll do another 15, 20 to 20 minutes-ish, and then we'll do a coffee break, okay? Nobody asked, but I know it's on everybody's mind already. All right. So everybody was able to go out to the web, by the way. Everybody was, some computers are not allowed to go. You're fine? Everybody is fine. In case you were not fine, I thought about you, and I provided some local backups for these files. Okay, so if you if you can't go to the web and you're too shy to tell me, you can just locally load these files. And if not, you'll be working with recent data. All right, so so we've done that, and that was nice. And okay, so you have a question, yes. Yeah, and unfortunately, that's the only thing we have. This file just has that information. Yeah, yeah. This is actually the date. It's a real date. Yeah, we don't want to lose that. It's a decimal version of the date. This was a fraction of 1993, so a little bit after 0.5, so it must be in July or something. Okay, yeah. All right, so what was I going to say? So we have two more data sets, kind of, that we loaded. I want to keep writing them. So we had a NOAA data set. That was the first one, super simple. Then there was the NASA one. I make the joke so that people remember which one it is. Okay, so it was the GISS TAMP. Okay, it's called GISS TAMP. And this one was annual data. Okay, and this one was monthly data. And then we just downloaded three data sets for northern, southern, and global, southern hemisphere and global for the sea level. Okay, so now we have from the University of Colorado. We have, what did we call it? We called it global sea level, and then northern sea level, and southern sea level. Okay, and we're going to learn to combine these guys together into one data frame so that we can do some interesting correlation within it and so on. Okay? But for now, we're going to stop. And we're going to load our last data set. I wanted to give you an example of a, I wanted to find an example of a, of a, of a different file format. So far, we've only been working with text data. And so this last URL was published by a university in the UK. And it's really cool. Because they have sea level stations all around the world. Okay, so they have a bunch of sea level stations. Okay, and one of which, actually, I won't say how many of which are in New York. Remember, we're trying to know if New York is going to flood at the end, right, of the century. So you have a bunch of sea level stations everywhere around the world. Okay, and so this is not time series data. I wanted to have an example that was not time series data. And so the nice thing is that you have the name of the station. Okay, so the New York one's going to have New York something in it. And if you care about a different city, you should use a different city. But the nice thing about this is that once we have this table, we'll be able to query this table because, let's say we wanted to know haiku. We wanted to know some data about in haiku. I have no, it's in China. So we could click on 1428, that's the ID, so one of the columns of those stations was an ID. And then once you click on the ID, you have a lot of information about the sea level at that station, okay? And so so here is the monthly data, and this is the annual data, okay? So you have the sea level data in haiku, okay? And so the nice thing here is that you could download that data. Once you know the name of your station, you can find the ID. Once you find the ID, you can build a URL to download the data corresponding to that. Okay, so the exercises that are taking us through this these notebooks are going to get you to download the data for any city you want, for example, New York, and we'll do, and the notebook at the end does shows you how to do some extrapolation of data to predict the future. Okay? So that's the goal. That is the reason why we're downloading this table, because we want to be able to query it to find some local data. Okay? Am I going too slowly? Is it about right? Okay. So again, it's going out to the web, so it's going to take a couple seconds. And the question is, what do we get from this read HTML? So this cell was the reason why we wanted to have a beautiful soup installed, because now Pandas is going to go to the web and download an HTML page, and then beautiful soup is being used to parse that page and find the tables in that page. Okay, so whenever you run a function and you don't know what you get, which is usually the case when you're discovering something new, what you should do is you should print what you got and you should look at it. Okay, and if you don't know what it is, what do you think this is? Very good. Okay, it looks like a table, but it's not a table. And the reason, the way to know that it's not a table and it's a list with a table in it, is to look at the first character. Okay, this is a list with a table. Okay, and we want the table inside the list. Okay, how do we get the first element of a list? Square bracket 0. Very good. Now I have a real table that's nicely represented. Before I had something that was a lot harder to look at. Okay. I should not have called it table list. Oops. I've lost. I don't know what's going on. Next time I'll call it X. No, so realistically, usually when you discover a package, you don't know what you get when you use a function. So you give it a name and then you ask type of that thing, what is this? Oh, okay, it's a dictionary, so I know how to use it. Or it's a list, I'm going to look at the number of elements in that list. I'm going to look at the first element and so on, okay? You have to become your own, it's kind of an exploration job, okay? So I'm going to grab that table list, I'm going to grab the first element, and I'm going to call it local sea level. And that's the last data set we're loading. Local sea level stations. So here we can do all kinds of interesting queries on that table, because we have if we look at the various columns we have. We have the station name. We have an ID. Remember, the ID will be useful. We have the latitude, the longitude. I don't know what this is, but there is a country code here. There is a date since which the station was updated, and we have a number for the coastline it is on, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this one was the University of I can't remember where in the UK, and this is our last data set. Questions? This was easy, right? We loaded our data pretty easily. Okay, we've done a tenth of the notebook. So let's continue. So the next question is, I just described that, okay? Once we have used a function like read table and we got something, we need to understand what is this something. First thing to do is to ask for the type of that something, okay? So what is the type of this GISS temp, for example? And that's a data frame. It's one of the core, used data structure in Pandas. So once you have an object and you wonder how to explore it, one thing you can do is to do dot and then tab to look at all the things you can find in that object, okay? So it's interesting the name of these first attributes. What are they? These attributes? They are the month, yeah. So automatically a data frame is going to expose all of its columns as attributes if you want to grab them with tab completion. Okay, that's useful. And then if we start exploring, we're going to recognize some of the things: divide, dot product, count, correlation, dot core, and so on and so forth. We have a dot column here. It's probably going to be useful if we want to know what columns we have in there. Seems like we have some plotting tools already attached to it, okay? So that's the whole point of Pandas. So once you get this thing, you're so powerful, but you don't know it yet. But you will know it soon. Okay? So all of these things this object, remember, its most important job is to store the data, okay? And I said earlier that it stores the data as a NumPy array or as a set of NumPy arrays, okay, to be more precise. And so that means that just like a NumPy array, you can ask this data frame, what is its shape, okay? So I'm going to print the shape, which is always something that's really useful to do when you're working with large amounts of data is to know how many columns you're talking about, how many rows you're talking about. Because if you have 2 million rows, you're going to work with it differently than if you have 143 rows. Okay? So this is a pretty small data set. I have 143 rows and 20 columns. And then the next question I'm asking this object is, what is the dtype? How many people know about the NumPy dtype attribute? Not very many, a few. You might have heard of it, yeah. So the first thing I asked on the cell above was the type of this object. That's a data frame, but the dtype, both in NumPy and in pandas, tells you the type of the elements of that array or of that data frame. Okay, and the really nice thing about a data frame is that each of the columns can have a different dtype, so you can have a column of dates, and then a column of integers, and a column of strings, and a column of floats, and so on and so forth, okay? You don't have to force everyone to be of a single dtype like in NumPy, so it's a lot more flexible. So there are a few dtypes that are supported in pandas. You have a question? No. And, what? Yes, go ahead. Yes, it does. So that's actually the point I'm making here, actually. So thank you for the question. So there are a few dtypes that are supported in pandas, but it's not as many as the number of dtypes that are supported in NumPy. Okay, so in pandas, you can have a column of float 64. That's kind of usually what you're going to be looking for when you have some data you're trying to analyze, right? You want a column of numbers so that you can calculate some averages and plots. Plot them and so on, okay? So float 64. You can also have a column of int 64. You can have a column of Boolean in pandas, okay? And then there is one or two more. You can have a column of categorical values, okay? An enum, male, female. You can have that in pandas. That's kind of new. But the last option, when pandas doesn't know how to store whatever's left, it's going to store it in an object column. Okay, it's going to say, I don't know what this is. I'm going to let you figure it out by yourself. So I'm going to store it as a Python object. Okay. Usually, when you get that, unless you're really doing some funny experiments like, you know, storing dictionaries in a data frame, which you should not do. Usually, when you see a column of object, it means that that pandas, the best it could do is to understand them as strings, okay? I could grab the first element and ask for the type of that, and you would see that it's a string, okay? And so what we're learning here is that our GISS temp, this messy data set, was loaded, but everything was understood as a string, not as a number. Can you guess why? Yes, because we had strings and numbers combined. Remember, the row at the bottom was a repeat of the headers. We should have done a footer, a skip footer, with one more row, maybe. That would not have saved us, though, because there were some more repeats everywhere in the file. This file was actually chunked and broken up, and there was a repeat of the headers over and over again. Thank you, NASA. We're gonna have to clean this up, okay? It's nothing surprising or nothing new under the sun. We're powerful enough to deal with it. So another really important thing that you want to ask once you have a data frame is, what is your index and what are your columns, okay? We know how many of elements we have in each, 143 and 20, but I want to see what they are. Okay, and so this index here, it's kind of a new thing. It's a new object in pandas 0.18. If you have an older pandas, you might have a different answer here, but hopefully everybody is on 0.18. And so it's telling you that it's a range index. It's just like the range in Python. It's going to be values from 0 to 143 with a step of 1. Okay. What are your columns? Your columns are year, January, February, and so on and so forth. Remember, we want that year to become our index, so we're going to learn to change that soon. And then we have all the months. And then we start having some other columns that I'm going to teach you how to throw away. We have January to December, and then we have like some combinations, some trimesters and stuff like that. Okay. Another really useful method on a data frame is to ask is to invoke .info, and it's a method, so you have to call it with open close parentheses. And that's going to give you all kinds of summary information about that data frame. It's going to tell you it's a data frame. It's going to tell you what its index is. And then it's going to repeat the different columns that it has. And also, it's going to tell you how many values, how many values were found and treated as non-missing. Remember the greenhouse gas data? When no value was found, it was treated as a missing value. So that one column, for example, would be completely missing. There would be zero non-null objects, non-null values. Okay. In this case, nothing is missing. Everything is successfully understood. But successfully understood as what? As a string. That's not very hard. Okay. That's not telling us if there are really some strings that are not understandable as floats. Yes. No. Thought there was a question. All right, remember that full globe temp? That was just annual data, okay? And so that's going to be our excuse to learn about the one-dimensional. So the data frame was the two-dimensional data structure to store data. And this full globe temp had only one column. And so it should be a pandas.series, but it's not. Because read table wants to be consistent. So read table wants to always give you a pandas data frame, even if there is only one column. Okay, so let's make a series. And we're going to make a series, and we'll come back to that heavily. But so we have this data frame here that is just a one column data frame. So we can make it a series by just requesting that one column. That's what I'm going to do here with the square bracket. I promise to spend more time on teaching you how to query your data set. Okay, so I'll come back to this square bracket and the name of the column notation. I'll come back in the second notebook. For now, I'm trying to focus on having some beautiful plots given to you before we go for coffee break, and I think I'm failing. So I want to move forward. But now we have a series. I've requested one column of a data frame. Now I have a series. Okay. So once I have a series, I have an object that is going to be very, very similar to a NumPy array. In fact, it used to be a subclass of a NumPy array. It's not anymore, but it's very similar to a NumPy array. So you can ask for the type of that guy. You can ask for the D type. You can ask for the shape. You can ask for the number of bytes, the amount of memory that it takes. Okay, so here is all the information that we could hope for on our time series. Okay, just like a data frame, a series is going to have an index, but it's not going to have any dot columns on the other end, of course, because there is only one set of values. And remember that we worked a little bit for that data set, and we had a parse dates equals true. Really, it's not that much work to get all that information, but we took the time to do that, and so now our index is a datetime index, okay? So that's going to be useful if we want to do date operations. So I want to point out that, and I've said that already, so it's not a surprise to you anymore. I want to remind you that even though we have chosen to explore our data using pandas, we have the power of the NumPy package and the NumPy ecosystem is never far away, because we can always convert our pandas object to a NumPy array and then pass that over to things that only understand NumPy arrays. And there are today still many, many things that only work with NumPy arrays. A few examples would be SciPy or scikit-learn. And so some of these tools that we have to use are always accessible by requesting the dot values on a pandas object, okay? So if I do, for example, my full globe 10, that's a series, I'm gonna get a one-dimensional NumPy array behind it, okay? Now I have this object, it's an array, it's a real good old NumPy array, so we can pass that over to any package that understands NumPy arrays. And there are many, that's why you're here. Okay, so so that's my story. I thought I had something else to. Yeah, I was just going to mention that when I wrote this comment about scikit-learn, I guess I didn't know about scikit-learn pandas. So that's why I mentioned that if you want to pass it over to do some machine learning, you need to export that back out to a NumPy array. I have never tried that scikit-learn pandas, so I recommend you take a look if you're interested in doing that kind of stuff. So before we break up for coffee, I'd like to show you one last thing, which is to create some. Real quick. It's going to take us 10 minutes. Okay, 10 minutes, and we do coffee break. I want to create some data frames manually, okay? I said earlier that if you have a data frame and you want a series, then what you need is to request one of the columns of the data frame, okay? So you can think of a data frame as a set of column, a set of series. You can think of it even as a dictionary of series. It would be an okay mental model. Okay, and so I'm going to create a data frame by providing to the data frame constructor a dictionary of series, and I'll build a data frame that way. What I'm working on right now, just to keep you in the big picture, is remember we downloaded from the University of Colorado some sea level data for northern, southern, and global hemisphere and the global, and now I want to put them all three into one data frame, okay? Problem is, I have two problems here. My first problem is that because I did a read table, what I got was three data frames, not three series. My second problem is that these data frames, or series if I can convert them to series, are not necessarily aligned. Okay, so let's check that they are aligned before we put them together in a data frame. So are they aligned? So remember the dot notation? If I want to access one column of a data frame, I can use the square bracket and the quotes, or I can use the dot notation. Okay, if I can only use the dot notation if the name of the column is friendly. Okay, if it has a space in the middle, I cannot do that, for example. Or if it has a dash, I can't do that either. Okay, in this case here is a nice column name. So I can check if the year column of the southern hemisphere is the same as the year column of the northern hemisphere. And instead of getting a true or false, I'm getting a bunch of trues and and maybe some falses. Okay? Who is surprised by all these booleans? Everybody's not surprised then? That's awesome. You're surprised? Okay. So remember, think of series. A column is a series. Think of series as roughly NumPy arrays. When you have two NumPy arrays and you test equality between them, you get equality element by element. So I'm getting a bunch of trues and falses here because it's testing, is the first element equal to the first element of the other one? Second, third, and so on, okay? So I'm getting a bunch of booleans, and really my question was, are they all true, okay? So I'm gonna have to ask that question and be a little more specific and say, are these guys all true? Okay, so that's why I'm pulling out the all function from NumPy, np.all, are they all true? And the answer is yes. So these two series are aligned. Great. So I can put them together in a data frame with no problem. So I'm going to do that. What about the global data set? I'm not even testing equality. Here I'm going to be testing the length of these year columns. And in this case, the global data set compared to the northern, it's false. It's not even the same length. Okay, so there is no chance they are the same. These data sets are not aligned, yes? Yeah, so that's thank you. I'm going to continue. All right, so for now, I'm not going to worry about this global one, and I'm going to answer your question soon, okay? But for now, I'm just going to try to put the northern hemisphere in a data frame together with the southern hemisphere in a data frame. So I'm going to, remember, I'm going to make a dictionary of series, okay? How do I make a series from the data frames that I had? I need to do square brackets, or I could have done the dot notation as well. In this case, square bracket and the name of the column I want. Okay, so remember that they are aligned. So the year column of the northern and southern hemisphere are the same. I can grab any that I want, and then I'm going to grab that MSL column that had the actual sea level data, and everything else I'm going to throw it away. So that's how I'm throwing away all these NANs that I didn't care about. I'm just grabbing the other column anyway. Okay. So I'm making a dictionary of those, and I'm passing it to pd.dataframe. Now I have these two data sets next to each other. That's pretty good. We're making progress. Once they are together, you'll see after coffee break how easy it is to deal with them together once they are together in the same data frame. Okay. We'll plot them together. We'll calculate correlations together. Super easily, okay? And I have the dates next to them. So, problem is that my dates, I wanted them as the index, okay? So I'm gonna show you another way to create a data frame is that you can provide a dictionary of a series, and then you can specify my index being equal to, and then provide another list of values or array of values or series, okay? So I'm going to say index equals this. Do you guys see any problem with this? Some of you who have experience with pandas? Let me reprint my data frame that I'm about to, or an example of that data frame. Do you see a problem with what I'm trying to do here? Not yet. Let me show you what happens. So what I'm showing you is probably the strongest feature of pandas, okay? And yet, right now, it's working against us. But I'll show you later how it can work for us in an amazing way. Okay, so what's happening here? It's full of NANs, okay? I specified my, if I didn't specify an index, it worked great. Oops, sorry. If I didn't specify an index, if I put the date as a regular column, it works great. And then as soon as I specify those dates as my index, it falls apart, okay? So what's happening? So if you've worked with NumPy, you know that the golden rule of NumPy is every operation is done element by element, okay? If I say A plus B, the plus operation is going to be applied to the first two elements of A, and then the second two elements of A and B, and then the second two elements, and the third elements, and so on, element by element. Pandas has a different philosophy. Pandas is going to do every operation index by index, okay? This is going to be an amazing feature because if I have two time series that are not aligned, and I do A plus B, is going to automatically align the series and then do A plus B for all the same indexes, okay? So this is gonna be the most amazing feature of pandas, in my opinion. Problem is that right now it's working against us. Why? Because, so here is how pandas think when you give it this. Pandas thinks, okay, I'm gonna make a data frame, and my data frame is going to be indexed on those years, okay? So that means that I want a value for 1992 point blah, 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 I can't remember. and then 1993 point blah, 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 okay? And then it's asking this series, this one here, do you have a value for 1992 point blah, blah, blah? And the answer, I see someone shaking his head over there. The answer is no, the series doesn't have a value for 1992 blah, blah, blah. Can you tell me why? No, not floating point. What? So this series MSL IB, what does it have? Does it have values for instead of 1992? 0, 1, 2, 3, very good. Okay, this series here was not set correctly for this to be the index. So this series here, once I extract it, only knows values corresponding to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? And when the data frame constructor says, do you have a value for 1992? The series says no, we end up with a none, and so on and so forth. Okay? Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it would have found it. Yeah, it would have found it. Okay, so we need to do things differently here. Okay, so there are many ways to fix this problem. You've proposed one of them over there. We could reload our data sets and index them properly. That would be a great way, in fact. Or since we've loaded them already, we could, after the fact, set the index. I'll show you how to do that later. Set the index to that column, and now it knows how to be indexed in a different way. Okay, I'm gonna show you a third way to fix that problem, and in fact, I like that third way even less than the two that you've proposed. Okay, so my third way to fix that problem is to say, you know what? Don't try to be smart. I know that these quantities are aligned, and so don't try to be smart. I'm not gonna keep a series here. I'm just gonna do dot values. To just grab the NumPy array behind it, okay? Whenever you make a data frame manually, as for the columns, for the values in the columns, you can provide a series, but you can also provide a NumPy array, or you can also provide just a list of values. Does that make sense? Please raise your hand if it doesn't. I can explain that again.
Yes.
Okay, it does make sense. All right, so now it works. Okay, but I like her idea better. In fact, I've been meaning to fix that notebook for a while. Pull requests are accepted.
I have a question. So because you use the values, even if...
Yes.
But we checked that the index
yes.
were aligned.
Yes.
But supposing they weren't, it would still work.
Yes, and it would be all messed up.
It
would be wrong. So that's why I don't like this method. In reality, we should have done it in a different way. Okay. All right. 320. We have a lot more to go, so I'm going to propose only 10 minutes for coffee break. I hope it's okay. So we'll start at actually 11 minutes. So we'll start at 3:30 again, and we'll finish. We'll continue that. Okay. All right. So it's time to start cleaning our data. We've worked hard at making our data sets, and so we're starting to simplify our picture here, because now our northern and southern sea level is becoming just one data frame. I still haven't worked on aligning the global data set with the rest, but now I've worked enough that that's going to become very easy. You'll see that in a few cells. Okay, so now I want to clean things up, and just to get you to understand why I need to clean things up. Let me see if I can. No, how do I? All right, so one guy still needs to be cleaned, okay? And so earlier, this data set reported that there were no missing values. But in fact, if you look closely, there should be a bunch of missing values. So first, I didn't spend much time emphasizing it, but notice that this data set was broken up into chunks with spaces in between, and pandas just jumped over it, no problem, okay? So that was nice. But then because of all these intermediate rows of repeat headers, we ended up with a column of strings. So nothing is a number yet, everything is a string. There are also some values that are missing. This data set, so I gave that tutorial a year ago, so right around May of 2015, I downloaded this data set, and that's why it's missing some data for 2015. So we do have some missing values, and if we look with our eyes, we know that these are missing values. So if I have 4 stars, I have some missing values, and then I have all these rows here that I'm going to need to clean up, okay, before I can plot this data. So that's what I want to do now. Another thing that I want to do is if I look at all the columns of this local sea level stations data. Some of these columns, I would like to rename them. I would like to clean up their names because I can't use them directly. So, for example, I said that if there are some spaces inside the column name, then I can't use it with the dot notation. Another thing that's problematic is that this dot inside the name is going to prevent these latitude and longitude from being accessible with the dot notation as well. So I just want to show you that you can ask for the dot columns and you get it, but you can also reassign to this columns attribute. You can reassign a new list of column names that you like better. Yes. Sorry, yes, I started talking about one thing and then I realized that I was doing another cleanup first. So I started talking about the fact that GISS temp had some strings in the middle, and we're going to fix that. We're going to clean that up. But before that, what I'm cleaning up is these local sea level column names. You should. Okay. One nice trick about notebooks, Python notebooks, is that you can do cell and then run all above. So you could rerun stuff, or you can go back up, and this local sea level station was loaded from the read HTML. So it was cell around 25, and then the table list should give you this. Can you take a look? Thank you. Ben is on the way. It was the local sea level. So if you run it locally, then you might have a different list. Instead of grabbing the first element of that list, you might have to grab the last one. Did you really get a table? Did you get that same table? You should. Okay. So that's why. Now it all makes sense. So the local one. If you do the local one, let me show you here real quick, and then we're on our way. So I'm going to read the local one. I, I'm I'm sure I'm going to mess things up. It's going to be your fault. So I'm loading. I've loaded the local file. Now, if I look at table list, So you see, so there are some things. I don't know why, but when I downloaded that HTML, the HTML was different from when you go and fetch it directly off the web. And so the table that you want is the last one. Look. Okay, so instead of table list of 0, you want table list of -1. Awesome. Thank you for the question. I would have mentioned it if you had said you loaded locally. Never hesitate to share with me where you are. Okay, so I'm just showing you here an example of cleaning up the column names by using list comprehension. How many people are not familiar with list comprehensions? Okay, so list comprehensions in 20 seconds is a way to create a new list from an existing list. Okay, and the syntax is to start with a square bracket and say, I want a list of these things for a variable in an existing list. Okay, so for example, we can't see the cell. I have here local sea level stations columns. These are the existing columns. Okay. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to loop over every single column name in these existing columns, and I'm going to make a new list of name.strip, because you see there are some spaces. So I'm going to do a name.strip.replace of the dot by nothing, and that's going to be a new list of names, okay? Is that clear enough? Let me show you this separately. Okay, so these are the columns above, but I can say I want to make a new list of names, and you see that these new names, they are, so you build them however you want, okay? You don't have to do a list comprehension here. It's just an example. Okay, so I'm making a new list of names. For all the names in the columns, I'm making a name.strip.replace. Does that make sense? So I'm going to use that new list of names. I could have typed it in manually if I wanted to. List comprehensions are pretty cool. So if you're not familiar with them, you should become familiar with them. Python people like them a lot. So now my new columns are going to be cleaned up. You see the lat doesn't have a dot anymore. The long doesn't have a dot anymore. And all these column names don't have spaces at the end anymore. Okay, so they are all stripped up. And another thing that we can do is we can name the indexes. Okay, so it's just a detail. I'm not going to spend much time, but this mean sea level data set right now, where I have the northern and southern hemisphere, it has an index, and that index is called year. But if you look at it closely, it's more than the year. We discussed that already, right? It's just telling you even the day of that data. So instead of calling it year, I would like to call it date. So you can do that. You can grab the index and you can rename its name to date. Okay. So now I have date up there. Cool. So these are little cleanup operations. Another cleanup I'm going to do. And then I'm really going to get to that cleanup of the big cleanup of GISS temp. Is if I look at the temperature data from NOAA, at the end I have a -999, and I don't remember a super mega freeze in 2010. So this -999 is probably not true. And so I'd like to mark it as a real missing value. Okay, it's missing. I want to treat it properly, because if I do a dot mean on that guy for now, I'm going to be my mean is going to be taken down because of this value. Okay, so you got to do that. Okay, so I'm going to look everywhere where this series is equal to -999. Okay, and that's going to give me true or false. Remember, just like a NumPy array, this operation will be applied to every element, and whenever it's going to be true. It's going to be equal. I'm going to get a true. And so I can use this to modify those entries in the series, because here you see the ellipsis. I don't know how many values are missing, okay? And I want to clean them up all together at once. So I'm going to make what people call a mask, okay? With this equality up there, I'm making a mask, and I'm saying, I'm getting a series of Boolean values. That's my mask. And now I can use my mask. I could use my mask to ask for the values. Let me show you that. I can use my mask to say, what are the values of, this would mean, in plain English, this would mean, what are the temperature values when the temperature values are equal to -99? So obviously it's going to tell me -99, okay? But the other thing you can do is you can use your mask to reassign another value. You can say, wherever it's equal to -99, I would like you to make it equal to np.nan, okay? Again, Pandas is built on top of NumPy, and so it's going to understand NumPy's version of not a number, nan, okay? So as soon as I said that to nan, you see that if I ask for the tail of my series, now I have a proper nan, and now when I ask for the average temperature difference, I'm going to get a clean average that's going to ignore the missing values. All right, another thing that we've been wanting to do for a while, somebody in the back had suggested that, or maybe I did, I can't remember, is this GISS temp. It would be nice to set the year column as the index. Okay, so I'm going to do that now. We know how to do that during loading. I'm going to do that after the fact by using the set index method of the data frame, okay? So now if I say set index is the year and I ask for the top of that data frame, I'm going to get that year as my new index. And that that column of 0, 1, 2, 3s has been dropped out, has been removed, okay? If you don't want to lose, yes? Sure. Oh, I just looked at it. Sure. So sometimes you want to throw away your index and set a different column to that index as your new index. Sometimes you don't want to lose your existing index, so you want to promote. What you could do then is to promote your current index as a regular column. Okay, so if you wanted to do this, instead of set index, you can do reset index. Okay, so the exact opposite operation of what I'm doing here would be reset index. The year would become a column again, and I would get a new index that would be 0, 1, 2, 3. All right, now I'm going to continue cleaning up those GISS temp data sets. Okay, so it's my monthly temperature data. Okay, I have all the months. And then I have a bunch of columns that I don't really care about, so I'm going to start by throwing away all these columns. Okay, one way to drop a column, actually to drop a row as well, is to use the dot drop method. Okay, so for example, one of my columns that I really do not care about is year.1. Why is it called year.1? If you look at the file, there is no year.1 column. There was a year column and then another year column. And Pandas detected that there was going to be a collision of column names, and that's not allowed, just like in a dictionary. And so it renamed the last column as year.1. It's just a repeat of the data. Okay, so I don't care about this one. So I'm going to do a dot drop of that column. Okay. And so by default, when you do a dot drop, you need to specify the indexing value to access that. Okay, so you say dot drop, and you specify an index. If you want to specify an index name, if you want to specify a column name instead of an index name, you need to specify that it's along axis equals 1. So the syntax here, axis equals 0 or axis equals 1, is exactly identical to what NumPy does. Okay? So in 2D, for example, axis equals 0 is always going to be this axis along all the indices, and axis equals 1 is always going to be in this direction. So in this case here, I am saying drop the entry corresponding to year.1, and it will remove this entire column. So now, if I look, I don't have that last column anymore. I could continue doing this over and over again with all the columns at the end that I don't care about. Okay? I'm going to show you another way to do this faster. What I've done here is I've looked at all my columns, and I've noticed that all the columns that I want, they are next to each other. So I copied all the columns from January to December. And instead of dropping the things I don't want, now I'm going to be selecting the things that I do want. Okay? So I'm going to say GISS temp, square bracket. Square bracket's going to allow me to request a column. But instead of passing one column here, I'm passing 12 columns with all the month that I want. And that and I am overriding GISS temp with that result. So that, in effect, is going to throw away everything else. Yes? Oh, yeah, yeah, very good. So the only reason why I have these U's here is because I did a copy and paste. Okay, and U in front of a string, outside of that string, means it's a Unicode string. So it doesn't matter. You don't have to have it. It's going to be treated the same. But it's just a Unicode string as opposed to a byte string. Yes. Okay, it works. I'm going to remove one of the U's. And it still works. All right. Now I have a question for you. So look at this data set. Look at it hard. And tell me how am I going to do to drop all the rows that have a repeat of the header. Don't look at the notebook. Look at my screen. Okay. So I know that I have a bunch of these things everywhere. I can drop all of them in one operation by doing a dot drop on what index? Year, very good. The way to designate this row and every other row, remember somebody was asking me about duplicate rows? Okay, I have duplicate rows here, and I'm going to drop them all by doing a dot drop on that value. The drop of year, okay? Very different from the year we had earlier, yes? No, very good question. If I don't, then it falls back to the default value for drop. Okay, if I do a question mark, I bet you that axis equals by default is zero, actually, for sure. And so I don't have to specify. I could have done it. I could have specified it, but it would be extra work and I'm lazy. All right. And then the last thing I'm going to do, we still have these stars we want to remove. Okay, so we want to look everywhere where that data frame contains a quadruple star. Just like with the -999 earlier, I tested for the equality to -999. I'm going to be testing for the equality to the four stars, and I'm going to assign that to np.nan, okay? I'm going to do it, so I could have done that, okay? I look for whenever it's equal to four stars, and I set it to nan. Another way to do this is to use the where method on the data frame, so I'm just showing you two different ways. If you don't want to learn a new way, you can just keep this. But here is an excuse to show you another method on a data frame. You can build this where method allows you to build a data frame out of multiple data frames, okay? Out of two data frames. You can say, I'm going to build a new data frame, and that new data frame is going to be equal to this data frame wherever this is true, and otherwise it will be built from this data frame, okay? So I'm going to say that wherever GISS temp is not equal to four stars, I want the values of GISS temps, and otherwise I want, well, I can just specify also one value and I'll get nans, okay? So it's exactly the same. And now if I look at the tail of my data set, I have nans everywhere. So a big difference between NumPy arrays and data frames is that NumPy arrays, once you have allocated them, because they are memory efficient, they don't easily allow you to add data. Whenever you want to append data to a NumPy array, it's going to force a copy of this NumPy array and all the data to somewhere else in memory where it can fit everything. Okay, but pandas data frames allow are designed to be extensible easily, okay, and not necessarily require that. Okay, so so whenever, just like with a dictionary, remember my mental model of a data frame being a dictionary of a series. I'm going to add a new entry in my data frame, and I am going to because I still want to put the global sea level. I still would like to put my global sea level inside this data frame. Okay, and so I'm going to create a new entry in this data frame. I'm going to call it mean global, and I would like to have this column. Okay, do you think this is going to work? It's hard because we had coffee break, and so you forgot what these things look like. So let me show you again. This is the series I want to inject in there. Okay, and I want to inject it into this data set. Do you think it's going to work? What? There are different sizes. True. Any other problem? Actually, the different sizes is not a problem, but the index is the problem, right? They are not aligned. They are still not aligned, but now we know how to align them. We know the set index. Okay, so right now that mean global still has the same problem. I'm not going to explain it again. You understood, I think. Okay, the different sizes is not a problem because pandas does everything index by index. So as long as the indexes are correct, even if I have four values, it's going to find them and put them in the right place. This is the most amazing feature, again. Okay. So what I need to do is I need to properly set the index of my global data set to the year, and then it's going to work. Okay, so I'm going to do that because now I know the set index. Okay, so I'm going to set the index to be the year, and then I'm putting it in. And just like, I don't know who said that, but it was a very good point. The series are not the same. They are not the same length, but they have some of the same indices, and so pandas is going to automatically align them super fast, and I have my data set automatically aligned. Okay? There was a question. No longer. Yes. Very good question. Excellent question. So, they are not the same, so there might be values that are in the data frame that are not in the series, and vice versa. Okay, so because I am bringing some data into the data frame, the guy who defines who we care about is the data frame. Okay, so any value that the series has and the data frame doesn't have will be dropped as well. Okay, if you So I'm going to add one more thing because I'm afraid not to have time to talk about it. Later in the notebook, I'm going to show another method called align. And the align, it's a method on data frames or on series that allows you to take two series. Now it's more democratic. You have two series and you say align with each other. And so it's going to inject all the missing values in both of them and give you two new series that are aligned. Okay, if you do a lot of operations between unaligned series, you should align them first and then do the operations, will be faster. Okay, and then whenever you align, you could specify, do you want to align by doing a join of all the indices, or do you want to do an align on the left or an align on the right, or an outer join or an inner join? Okay, so you have it all. I have a little exercise here, but it's super easy, so I'm just going to do it myself. Is that okay? Because I have some more interesting exercises after, and we're short on time. So I guess I should say it differently. I don't like this exercise so well, so I want to do it. I don't think it's worth your time. But basically, the goal of this exercise is to show you, and I really want to drive home this concept that everything between series is done index by index instead of element by element. Okay, so when you do an operation between unaligned series, the alignment is done automatically. Okay, so so here I wanted to create a new series that was the average of the two hemisphere minus the global. Okay, maybe it would have a meaning. Okay, and so what happens in this case is just to show you that it just works. Okay, so if I say minus this, if I take the average of the two hemispheres, northern sea level, and I'm gonna do southern sea level. Okay, so I'm taking the average of the two series, and I'm badly running out of space, and I've modified them now. I'm going too fast. So southern sea level is it was the last one. Okay, the one that doesn't have this column anymore is the global sea level because I overwrote it. Okay, so if I show you this global sea level, you'll see that this one, its index was set to the year now. Okay, and so I'm gonna work with this guy, and I'm gonna work with the data frame called the mean sea level. Okay, this guy is also aligned correctly with all the dates as the index. And so now I can do operations between columns of that data frame and the global sea level data frame without having to worry about the fact that they are not aligned. Okay, so I can do mean sea level dot northern hemisphere plus mean sea level dot southern hemisphere. I'm going to take the average of the two and subtract global sea level dot this. Okay. And this one has some funny characters, so I'm going to need to use it as a string. This notebook has become smarter than me, so it's like doing all kinds of things for me. All right, so here it is. So I'm calculating averages between unaligned series, and it's just going to do the alignment automatically. Okay, so for all the values where the global sea level, for all the indices, for all the dates where the global sea level doesn't have a value, I'll end up with a missing value, and everything else automatically will align and do the computation. Okay, and so if you do the average of the two hemispheres, and you subtract the global, if it's close to zero, I guess it means that the global is about that, but the southern hemisphere has way more water than the northern hemisphere, so it's not close to zero. All right, I wanna do one last step. We're almost ready to plot all of our data set after that much work. But there is still one thing that we need to do, is our GISS temp. Remember, we cleaned it all up. We removed all the stars. We removed all the duplicate headers and stuff like this. But we still cannot plot it because everything is still considered a string, an object, okay? So I can't plot this guy, I can't calculate anything. Okay, so it's now almost clean, but not quite clean. All the numbers are still understood as strings. And so one thing that you can do whenever you have a series is, just like with a NumPy array, you can change the D type of that series. I would like to force to cast or recast all the values inside that series as a float 32, for example. Okay, so I'm going to do that. And now if I look at my series, my D type is float 32. So I'm going to do that for all the columns of this data frame. Last time I checked, there was not an as type on a data frame, so you had to do it column by column. I don't want to type many times the same thing, so I'm going to do that in a for loop. So how do I collect, grab each column of my data frame? I'm going to grab the list of all the column names. I'm going to loop over them. I'm going to grab that column. And I didn't need to do something complicated here with my lock. I'm going to introduce that lock soon. I didn't have to do that. I could just have grabbed the column with the square bracket. And I'm going to cast each of these columns as type np.float32. OK? Does that make sense? Yes? So now, I'll be able to plot my data. If I look at the D type of my index, remember those years? They were also treated as strings. And so I could do the same operation on my index as well. Okay, the D type of my index is also an object. Would be nicer if it was an integer. I guess for now it's a year. And we'll learn to convert it to an actual date time also. Okay, so I'm going to do an as type on the index as well. So now we've worked on identifying all of our missing values and making them proper numpy.nan, and that gives us the ability to use all of the missing value management functions in pandas. Okay, so once you have values that are missing, you can decide what to do with them. You could just keep them just to remember that for that year you didn't have a value. And nicely, pandas is going to ignore it. That's another difference with NumPy. Pandas is going to ignore all the missing values. For example, when you calculate an average, it will calculate the average across all the non-missing values and leave out the missing ones. Okay? NumPy would not do that by default. Okay? So now that I have a NaN properly identified, I can drop all the missing values. You see that now 2010 is gone from my series. Little question here, little quiz. Did I modify, when I did a call to drop NA, did I modify full globe temp, or is it giving me another series, but the original one is not modified? I modified it. Who thinks I modified my series? Couple, three? Who thinks I did not modify my series? More people. The majority is right, always. It's democracy. but it turns out that they are correct. And so that's what I wanted to teach, is that whenever you do an operation on a series, if that operation returns a new series, it means the original one was not modified. Okay, so if you wanted to actually modify that series, you would have to say full globe temp equals full globe temp dot drop NA. Okay, so I'm going to be playing around with these drop NA. So for example, you could do a drop NA on the GISS temp as well. Remember, the GISS temp is missing a few values in 2015. But now I'm in 2D, so when I say drop NA, I have more control, and I need to specify what do I mean. Do I mean drop a row whenever one value is missing, or drop the row when every value is missing? Okay, so you can specify how equals any or all that to control things that way. Okay, so any is going to drop 2015 because there was one NaN in there, and all would not. Okay. Okay, because I had some values in 2015. Another thing I can do, so drop NA. Another thing I can do is fill NA. I can can pad stuff with zeros. Okay, so I can say fill NA value equals zeros. And now I have a bunch of zeros in there. It's not very smart to do that. It's gonna mess up everything in my calculations, so I'm not going to do anything with this data frame. Another more interesting thing in this case is a forward fill. You can do a fill NA, and instead of providing a value, you can say, just take whatever value was before. Okay? And now my 2015 for the rest of the year is going to have the same values as the year before. That might be an okay thing to do. I don't know. It depends on your problem. Okay. And then I'm going to mention one more thing that's nice. Is you can do an interpolate. You can interpolate away automatically all your missing values from the values around it. Okay, so for example, I'm grabbing my GISS, but that is only defined, at least last time I checked, was only defined on a series, not on a data frame. Okay, so you have to do that series by series. So you can say GISS time, I'm going to grab August, and I'm going to interpolate whatever values are missing in August, okay? Yes. Yes. So the way you would figure this out is you would put a question mark on interpolate, and so if you're like me and you don't know it off the top of your head, you do question mark on the guy, and then you look at the different options that you have, just like with read table, and you find all kinds of nice options. Okay, great question. Thank you. Let's do some visualizations. I am assuming I don't have a ton of exercises. I have more later on, but I'm trying to move forward that way. But I'm assuming that you guys are experimenting with all this as I am going through it. Okay, so. Please continue to have questions. Please continue to map everything that we're doing right now to the data problems that you have and continue asking questions. But we're still in the super basics, so I want to move forward, okay? So I promised you the moon, the sky, and the sun once we would have these super smart data structures, so I want to start benefiting from this. We've worked like dogs to get them cleaned up, and so now it's time to harvest the fruits of our labor. And so I'm going to show you that once you have a time series and a time series that's properly indexed with a date and cleaned up with missing values removed and so on and so forth, the amount of work to plot it and see your time series is exactly 5 letters. I guess 6 letters plus the dot. Okay, so it's pretty easy. Okay, and the nice thing here too, notice is that since we've made these guys dates, Pandas is going to understand that these are dates, is going to show you the dates on the decades or the half decades so that it looks nice, okay? So we're benefiting from how much that series knows about itself and about its data, okay? Remember that we took the time to specify that the index had a name and that name was year, and that's why we're getting a nice label and so on. This is still a matplotlib plot. So if you want, you can doctor it as much as you want. If you know matplotlib, you import matplotlib, you add a legend, you add a title, you add a Y label, you tweak the ticks, you do whatever you want. Yes. Just because I'm teaching, so I want it all to be on the same thing, not have to fiddle around. But yeah, if you pop it out, if you use a Qt4 backend instead of inline, so an inline is going to generate an SVG file, so it's static and not alive anymore. Indeed, if you do a Qt4 window, then you can zoom around and work with it much better. Say that again. That's awesome. So you would do what? Percent matplotlib notebook. I'm glad I came today. Thank you. So, it might be, I would probably have to rerun. Okay, so I'm not going to do it right now, but so percent matplotlib notebook sounds like a really nice option instead of inline. Inline is going to generate an SVG. So by the time your cell has been executed, your plot is frozen and is an image. A fixed image file, okay? So it's not live anymore. Thank you, Ben. So you have a series, you plot it with just by asking for dot plot. If you want to know all the bells and whistles that are directly, if you don't want to start learning about matplotlib, which you should want to, You can still do a dot plot question mark and see what are all the options that have been exposed to pandas directly, okay? But not everything has been exposed because it wouldn't make sense to reinvent matplotlib inside of pandas, okay? So you can put a question mark and see what you can tweak, or you can import matplotlib as PLT and modify things, okay? Another really nice thing is that if you have a time series, but a data frame with a bunch of time series in it, the amount of work to plot all of them at once is the same as dot plot again. Okay, so now I have the monthly series. So for each column, so I have a column for January. So one of these curves is January, and the legend is made automatically from the name of the columns and so on and so forth. Okay, it's nice. It's a little bit of a mess. Though, but it's pretty. Another thing I want to show you guys is that, so remember this mean sea level now has three columns, northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, and global. So you have them all together. So you can do a dot plot and you'll get something similar to this. Or you can specify subplots equal true. For those of you who know matplotlib, you know what subplot does. It makes little subplots. And so that's what I'm going to do here. So now I have my three columns plotted differently on different colors automatically and so on. Okay? The dates are nicely slanted, so it does a ton of work for us. It's hard to go back once you know pandas, to go back to not having it. Okay? Another thing, I'm going to show you a couple more advanced plotting capabilities inside pandas. I'll let you explore the rest by yourself. But one thing that you may want to see quickly is a distribution of your data, okay? And so one of the keywords of the plot method is the kind. So by default, the kind is going to be just a line plot. But you can say kind equals KDE. KDE stands for kernel density estimator. And it just does an estimation of your PDF of your data, okay? So if I look at my mean sea level, I can see the probability distribution function for all my columns. In fact, the global is left out. I believe it's because it has missing values. I'm going to have to look that up and get back to you on Slack or something about this, but I think that's the reason. Okay, but so at least we can see the distribution of values for the northern and southern hemisphere, so we get an estimation of the PDF for those values. It seems like it's slanted to the right, meaning it's getting hot. It's not getting hot. This is sea level, so it's getting high. Okay? What about another way to look at distributions? And you know what? I'm going to modify the cell. I'm going to do it on the so that I show you the same information. You can also do a box plot. Okay, so a box plot, people who come from finance that are very familiar with this type of plots, the box plot is going to show you a lot of statistical information automatically. So you end up with one box per column for each of the columns of your data frame. Mean sea level dot box plot. I just changed the name of the data frame to show it to you on. Okay, and so it's showing you the statistical properties of all these values in each of these columns. The red is going to show you the median. The box here is going to show you the 25 to 75 percentile of your data, and then the scope of these tails here is going to be 1.5 times the box, and then everything that's beyond that is going to be called outliers, and is going to be represented with a little cross. In fact, that might have been why I wanted to show it to you on this other one, is because it does have some nice outliers. Okay, so if I look at the temperatures, it seems like we have quite a few outliers on the hot temperatures. Conclude what you want. No. I'm back to the temperatures. Thank you, though. Keep me in check. I'm going to show you one last thing, which is pretty awesome. You could do all that by yourself in matplotlib, but that's why we have an awesome community behind us, is for us not to have to write a lot of code. They are doing the hard work, and we're using it. So I'm importing from pandas.tools.plotting this scatter matrix plots. Okay, and so I'm passing to scatter matrix my data frame of C-level data. And what I'm getting here is a scatter matrix plots, a matrix of plots, showing me the correlation between all of my columns. Okay, so for example, this is going to be the correlation of all the values. It's a scatter plot with the correlation of all the values between the southern hemisphere and the mean global. So it seems like the mean global is more correlated, the mean global sea level is more correlated to the southern hemisphere than the northern hemisphere, okay? Again, there are more oceans in the south. And then on the diagonal, because it would be the correlation of a column with itself, that would not be very interesting. So you get a histogram showing you the probability distribution function of all your data. Cool? All right. I'm going to stop here for some of the pretty images. If you are interested in doing more visualization of your data, look at what more Pandas has to offer. But again, go back to my slide. You'll remember the name of all these other packages that are pretty awesome. I've used Seaborn quite a bit, and I used to teach Seaborn. It's a really neat package for doing data exploration. It does a lot of plotting, but it also does some analysis for you. So go and explore Seaborn. Altair also is a new one that sounds really promising. The Seaborn, and the next one, Altair. I don't know how you pronounce it. Altair. Thank you. The guy behind Altair, the two guys at least that I know, is the same as the guy who is behind these notebooks and IPython tools, Brian Granger. It's also Jake Vanderplas. They just released 1.0 today. So now I can advertise for it. All right, I'm going to finish this. We're reaching the end of this first notebook. So we're all graduating to Advanced Pandas user very soon. But before we do that, I want to show you real quick how to store data back to disk. And I'm going to start by giving you an exercise. You want to store your data back to disk? Figure it out. I'm still giving you some information here. So remember all these read underscore functions that we had? So pd.read underscore CSV, read underscore table, and so on. For every single of these functions, read underscore and a format, there will be a to underscore and a format method on the data frames that you want or the series you want to store. Okay? So let me show you real quick. I'm going to get you started on this exercise. So create a cell behind the exercise. And let's say that so just store one of them. Okay? So you can say GIS stamp is the one I want to store. And then gissm dot, and then tab. So that's going to have a ton of things. But you can start typing to underscore, and then you see the list of methods that you have access to export things. So I would like you to export gissm stamp to a CSV file. I want you to do it yourself so that there is a guarantee that when you walk out this room, you know how to do it. Okay, and then I'll show you how to do it with Excel and HDF5. I'll give you 5 minutes. So find a method that's useful, then put a question mark on it, learn how it works, and use it to store GISS temp. Once you are really used to doing tab completion and question mark in IPython, you know how to explore the whole Python world by yourself. Okay, you don't need tutorial instructors anymore. So I'm gonna use that CSV, obviously, to... So two CSV, and the first argument is a path. So it seems pretty enough, right? Simple enough. Test.csv. So I should have my GISS temp in a test.csv file now. How do I check? One of the magic commands in IPython that I like and use all the time is %ls. to know what's available where I am or what are the files. And I have a test.csv, so it seems to have worked. Okay, so now another IPython trick or Jupyter Notebook trick now. I can do bang, exclamation point, and then I can type a command that I would type in my own Mac terminal. Okay, so if I wanted to open that file, I could do bang open test.csv. And that should show me yes, that's better. Okay, so now I have my work, my data, come on. That's my fault, Microsoft. I have my data set cleaned up and stored in a CSV file. I haven't wasted my time, okay? What was I gonna say? So that was easy enough. So what about other file formats? Any questions on this? Oh, if you are on Windows, I think instead of open, you can do start, and that might work. If not, you have to go on your file browser and find your file. You can trust me, it's going to work. So it worked. So I want to show you a couple more file options, file format options that are a tiny bit more complex, but worth it. If you want to store your data to Excel, I am assuming that a lot of you are using Excel. And so if you want to do that, one nice thing compared to CSV is that you can store multiple data sets on multiple sheets of your Excel notebook. Okay. Assuming that you have Excel writers in your Python distribution, I'm sorry I didn't put that on the list. I just added these cells and I didn't think about. So for some of you, this might not work. But you should be able to create an Excel writer. And once you have created an Excel writer with a file, then you can use that writer inside the toExcel method. Okay, so to underscore in the name of your format. Now it's Excel. And what I'm going to specify is the writer, basically the file I'm writing to. But then a sheet name, okay? So if I run this, it's going to export my data frame to Excel in that sheet, and I would like to also export that series to that other sheet, okay? Unfortunately, a series cannot be stored in an Excel sheet because it's a one-dimensional object, and 2Excel is going to work only on data frames, okay? So right now we're in a bad state because we have opened a file and we've tried to write to it and we were getting ready to close that file and we got messed up in the middle. And that's a good reminder that we should always be using with statements in Python when we write to files, okay? Because we don't know what could go wrong, okay? So I'm going to close my writer and I'm going to now reopen my writer in a safe way with the with statements. Okay, if you don't know about with statements, you should go and learn about them. But basically, the with statement is going to do that writing operation. And no matter what happens, it's going to safely close the file so that I don't end up with open file pointers. Okay, and so because a series does not have a 2Excel method, I'm going to create a data frame with that one series, and then I'm going to call 2Excel. Okay, that's a little bit annoying, though. But it works, okay? I'm going to propose a better file format. How many people have never heard of the file format called HDF5? I've never heard of it. Okay, just a few. Most of you know about it. HDF5 is a really, really good file format for storing binary data. There are amazing tools in the Python ecosystem for dealing with HDF5 files. It has the advantages of binary data without the inconvenience of if you don't know the exact binary format, you're lost and your file is trash because it creates a file that behaves a little bit like a file system where you can inside it, where you can explore the file as if it was a file system and you can ask, oh, do you have some folders and what do you have in there? So an HDF5 is a hierarchical file where you can have groups of data sets stored together. And the nice thing too is that you can store data frames or you can store series or you can store panels. which is the 3D version of Pandas data structure. And all of that will be stored cleanly in an HDFS, cleanly and efficiently. It's a really, really good file format. So I'm going to do that, and I'm hoping that everybody is in sync with me right now, because we want to store all these data sets so that we can reopen them in the next notebook. Okay? Everybody, nobody has broken their notebook. If you have broken your notebook and you want to follow along with the second notebook, you may want to open a backup notebook. Hopefully you've made a copy. Or you can manually export everything to CSV or something. Okay, so hopefully everybody has Pi tables. And whenever you run this this last cell, you're getting some warnings, and that's okay. Once you've done that, you have you do %ls, you should have a file called alldata.h5. Anyone did not get an alldata.h5? You? What happened? Kernel dies. Okay. So you'll have to okay. So good question. What do you do when the kernel dies? You go into kernel and then restart and run all. That would be what I would recommend you do. Okay? So it's going to rerun everything. If you've hopefully you've not made modifications, and we can continue that way. Anybody else has issues? Everybody has an H5 file on their disk? Anybody else is missing something? So right now, if you're missing some data sets because you had an installation problem, it's late to debug now, these installation problems. So hopefully you can export your data sets so that we can load them back up on the second notebook. If you have some issues there, try to resolve them. But as long as you have this last command only generating warnings and no error, you have your data sets stored and we can load them back up. Okay. So call. I'm gonna move forward. Call us. Call Ben if you still have some issues. Sorry. Do you have Pi tables installed? You could take the time to export them real quick inside Excel, and so do a 2 Excel instead of a 2 HDF. So the couple cells up, I started that already, so you could export all the different data sets that way. And you'll have to modify the top of the notebook too. All right, so I'd like to continue. How many people are still having issues that they're working through? Still one, a couple? Were you able to install the beautiful soup 4? No, were you able to have the? Do you run it all? It's all working. So hopefully most everybody is all good. So I'm going to start the second notebook. I don't know where I am. All right. So I'm going to do a Jupyter.notebook. And I want the climate time series part 2. And so by now we know how to load data, we know how to clean data, we know how to plot data, and we know how to write data. So we kind of have a workflow down. And now I want to show you some more of the features that we have in Pandas. And so we'll go as far as we can down this. My goal is still to look for correlations between temperature data and sea level data, and I'm going to continue that same story inside this second notebook. So I'm going to re-import everything. And at the end of part one, so we need to change again the location of the notebooks. And so remember that tab completion works in IPython. That's one of the nice things of IPython or Jupyter. So rely on that. And so climate time series. So again, if you got it right, and you do a %ls, you should have an old data.h5, and you should have a data slash. Are you back online? Awesome. You should have a data folder as well. Okay. So I'm going to reload the data. So in the previous notebook, we saw how to dump a bunch of data sets inside one HDFI file. Now we're going to do the same but the opposite operation to load them back up. Okay. I should have spent a tiny bit more time. I was worried about installation issues. And I just wanted to describe. So what I did with the HDF5 file was to define a file. So you define an HDF store, and it's a really neat object that you can use as a like a dictionary. Okay. So whenever we stored our data sets, we did two HDF5, and we provided the store. I should just show it. And we provided the store. But then we provided something else. Okay, I called it writer here. I should have called it store. Then what we provided is a node, and you see, so which is the location in the file where this one data set is going to be stored. Okay, and then the nice thing about this, about the way I did it, is that I grouped the different data sets in different nodes that start with the same name. And with these slashes here, so whenever you use HDF5 is a general file format, and they are little tools to explore an HDF5 file. So whenever somebody would look at this HDF5, it would find two different folders: one folder called temperatures, and one folder called sea level. And then inside each of these folders, they would find a couple of data sets each. Okay, so. It's just and you just get that by choosing some good names to group your data sets together. All right, so like I said, our HDF store can be used to retrieve our data a little bit like you would retrieve data from a dictionary. So I'm going to use a square bracket. And I'm going to specify the nodes, the path. You could think of it as the path to the data set inside this one file. And so everybody should be able to rerun this cell and have all of their data sets live again. If you don't, please raise your hand, and Ben can. What message do you get? Import error? I'm sure you can fix that one. We're good, Ben. We're good. So you probably forgot to rerun that cell at the top that re-imported everything. Python tries to be a little bit more specific than it's an important error. In 5 years of teaching at NTHOT, I've never had that comment. It was awesome. All right, so now section 5, I want to show you how to access your data. So we have these data sets, and I'm calling it accessing your data, which sounds maybe a little bit dry. I could call it query your data. Okay, now we have cleaned up our data sets, and we want to find stuff in it, but we can by the same token, we're going to be indexing into these things. So we're going to be querying our data set and starting to ask questions in our data sets. So how do you grab data out of a series, for example? So here is one of our data sets, our full globe temp. And It's a series, and so you can think of a series as a mapping between an index and a value, okay? And then we'll see the data frame is a mapping between a column name and a series, and then a panel would be a mapping between a slice name and a data frame, okay? The way you would use this full globe temp, and let's say you wanted to know what was the temperature in 1880 or in 2010, for example, you would say full globe temp, square bracket, and then the your value for your index. The problem is that our index here is a little bit complicated. It's not just a string, it's not just a number, it's a smart thing, it's a date time object. And so we need to, if I just say full globe temp of 2010, that's not going to work, okay? Because 2010 is not in the index. And even though initially it was a string, it's, this actually is going to work. So that's, yeah. So Pandas here is being really nice with us, even though our index is a datetime object, and we're giving it a string. It's going to try to understand that and convert that for us. Okay. If you didn't want to rely on Pandas being too nice with us, you could you remember that the index of our date of a series is a datetime. Okay. This is weird characters to describe to us that it's a datetime index, and so you should convert your string to a datetime object before you do the indexing. Okay, the first element of our index, our first date, is something that we can recreate or regenerate with this to datetime function. And so, if I want to grab 1880, for example, I can just request it with square bracket and then two datetimes of 1880. Okay. So you should all get one value. Whenever you do square bracket on a series, you provide the index, you get the value. Okay? The problem with square brackets is that it became quickly very overloaded. It became very complex to know what happens in certain situations. For example, if you say square bracket of zero, should it be looking for the first element in that series, or should it be looking for the value corresponding to zero, which might be somewhere anywhere in the series, and so on, okay? And so because that became quickly complicated, Pandas introduced other ways to index into your objects, okay? And so I'm going to introduce only two of them. There are many more, and I recommend you go back to the Pandas documentation to see the other ones. But I find that these two are the most reliable and my favorite way to index things. They are not the fastest, but they are flexible enough for me and still completely unambiguous. Okay, and so whenever you want to request a value based on the value of the index, you can use .lock, okay? So I'm going to do .lock, and I'm going to specify a value of an index, for example, to date time in 1990, and that's going to allow me to extract one value. Conversely, if I wanted to extract the value, the first value of in the series or the last value in the series, instead of doing .lock, so this is going to be index location, whereas iLock is going to be the position in the series no matter what the index is, okay? So iLock of zero will always give you the first element of the series no matter what, okay? Sometimes you don't remember what is the date of your first value, okay? Let's say you're wondering what is the last year you had a record, okay? Who is holding the years in that series is going to be the index. So if you want the last year, you can ask for the index of in minus one. Okay, we'll get the 2010. Okay. And then I showed you earlier that a data frame could be extended and you could add new columns by specifying a new column name and passing a new series. We're going to do more of that, but I also wanted to show you you can do that with a series as well. Okay, so you can say, I don't have an entry for 2011, but that's okay. I'm going to create a new one. And Pandas is going to be just fine with you wanting to do that. Maybe you want to do that, and then later on, you will fill it up with something meaningful. Okay. So what about indexing things in a 2D table? That's going to allow us to do start doing some queries, and we'll do a little exercise with that. Okay. So remember, if you do a square directly in the square bracket operation on a data frame, what you're getting is one of the columns. Okay. So you better provide a column name. So you can do that. And then quickly it becomes potentially complicated what you mean. So I recommend you use .lock or .iloc again. Okay. The only difference is that now we have two values we need to specify. Whenever we are in a 2D table and we do a .lock, we'll need to specify the row index first and then the column index second. In NumPy, in Pandas, it's always like that, always row first, column second. So I'm going to specify, I was born in December 79, so I'm going to specify that I would like the row 1979 and the column corresponding to December. Okay. Just like with NumPy arrays, the .lock and .iloc, in fact, will support you requesting more than one value. This is called fancy indexing. In one of the dimensions, you can request more than one value. For example, I would like for 1979, I would like both November and December. Oops. Oh, thank you. Sorry for the typo. Okay. Thank you, guys. All right, so this is called fancy indexing. You should recognize this from NumPy. Another thing that's really nice that you can do is you can do slicing. So again, just like with NumPy, the difference being that in NumPy, you can only slice from value number zero until value number blah, or you know, you can go from one place to another, but you have to specify a number. In this situation with Pandas, now that we have names for our values, we can do slicing even using those labels. Okay, for example, I would like all the values from January to June in 1979. Or I would like every other values in 1979. Okay, so every time I have to remember, I have to ask myself whenever I'm querying something, what rows do I want first? And then what columns do I want second? Okay, there will always be a comma between the two. Okay, and then you can specify a slice or a fancy indexing or just one value in each of the sites. Okay, this column two, how many people are not familiar with this notation? So please ask me if I'm writing things you don't follow. So whenever you specify a column, like here, it allows you to take a slice, to go from somewhere to somewhere, optionally with a step. If you don't specify from where, it means from the beginning. If you don't specify to where, it means from all the way to the end. Okay? So a column alone means I want everything. Okay? That means from the beginning to the end, and I'm omitting these details. Okay? And then if you put a second column, you can specify a step. I want every other element, for example. So the column two means I want to go from the beginning to the end, and I want to jump with a step of two. We're good? All right. The last thing I'm going to show you, and we've kind of done that already, but I want to, you know, formally introduce it, is we've talked about these masks earlier. We were looking for places where the value was equal to minus 999. Okay, so we've built masks that way. In general, a mask is just a set of values that has to have the same dimension as the dimension you're using to index into, and that specify true or false whether you want the value or not. Okay, so let's say that I'm doing this mask of true false times 6. What does that mean? Can someone tell me? This mask here, what is it going to look like? Yeah, repeating it, okay? A list, if you do a list multiplied by a number, it's going to duplicate that list, however number you're asking, okay? So here I've made a true false times 6, so it means that I have true false 6 times. So how many values do I have total? 12, okay? And now I am asking, I am going to do some indexing. I'm going to use iloc, so it's going to be based on the position. And I would like the first row, and I would like, in effect, every other element in the column dimension. Okay, so I would like the first year, every other month. And in the second case, I'm using lock. I can still use masking in there. It's another form of fancy indexing. But there, I'm going to have to specify not 0, but the actual value for the row that I want. Okay? All right, so I'm spending a fair amount of time on this because querying your data is a really important thing. Once you have it in there, you definitely want to be able to access it. Okay? I've already mentioned that we can create new entries in a data frame, new columns in a data frame by specifying square bracket and a new column name, and then passing in there, making that equal to a new series. So I'm going to create a new series, and that new series will be my entire data set, and I am summing up all the values along which axis? I'm summing up all the values along my axis 1. Okay, so I am basically, for each year, I am summing up all of the months, and I'm calling that totals. Okay, that is something that you'll want to do when you explore your data. Okay, I don't think in this precise problem it has any value, but now I have a new column here, and I have these values are the sum along axis 1, so it's going to have the sum for all the months. Okay? I didn't really need that column, so I'm going to drop it. And I'm going to do a little bit more queries, and then I'll let you do some as well. Okay? So let's look at these local sea level stations. Okay? So let's say, so I have these columns. And let's say that I would like to know what are the names and the IDs of all these sea level stations, but only for the United States. How would I do this? Okay. Whenever I am requesting some values out of a data frame, that's going to be a lookup or an indexing operation. We know two operators to do indexing, lock and iloc. Okay. So we know that much, so we can start typing. I don't want to show you the result. I want to build it with you. Okay. So we can start typing. So we know we want to do a lock. And then the question is, I guess lock or iloc. If I want to find the US, I want to be able to specify the values. So it's going to be lock. Okay. So now, which rows do I want and which columns do I want? Can you help me? I would like all rows and the station column, the station name. That's not quite enough. That's not quite correct. But let's continue fighting with that. Yeah. Okay. We only want the United States stations. Okay. So we don't want all rows. If we wanted all rows, we would just put a column. But in fact, we want to mask that. Okay. So how do we build our mask? We need to build something that's going to be true when the country is the USA and it's going to be false otherwise. Okay, so how do I do this? So local sea level station, I'm going to grab the country. And then I want to know when that is equal to. That's right. Okay, so that's my rows. I'm going to be masking everybody else. I'm going to be building a mass by building this logical relation, okay? So this, if I've done this right, my mask should have a length that is identical to my local sea level station dot shape, should have the same number of rows, right? If I mess something up, I would end up with the wrong number of values. Okay, so my mask here is going to be true when the country is equal to the USA. So I like that. Okay, and now I was asking for the names and the IDs for all the American stations. Okay, so what do I want for my columns? Names and IDs. Okay. All right, so I'm not going to type it because it was already typed. So I'm going to make an American station's mask. Okay, just like we did. And then for the columns, I want to see names and IDs. Question over there? Go ahead. You got an error when you try to make your mask? What error did you get? Can you look at the columns? All right, so we got it. So I'm going to give you a little exercise. So here is the exercise. I would like to print all the European countries that have some sea level stations. Okay, so I just would like a list of countries, and I'm going to define being in Europe, because we don't have a continent column, I'm going to define being in Europe as having a station within a certain range of latitude and longitude. Okay, so if you are a country that has a range between 30 and 70, and a longitude between minus 10 and 40, then I'm going to treat you as a European country. I'm not much of a cartographer either. Okay. So go ahead and make a query on there, and I would like the list of countries. You can grab the station names as well if you want, that have a latitude and longitude within these boundaries. You're going to need to combine multiple masks now, because you need to compare the latitude to two different things and the longitude to two different things. So you're going to need to use the NumPy operators for combining masks together. So if you want to do an AND, you have to use the ampersand. If you want to do an OR, you need to use the pipe symbol. Okay? I'm going to give you 5 minutes. Call me so that I can help you if this sounds difficult. So we're going to do that. I'm going to show an example on how to do that soon. But basically, you have to write a little function that does the IN and apply that everywhere. So there is an apply method. So section 7, I think, I'm going to show that, okay? Right now, I haven't taught how to do this. Sure. Oh, you're saying in terms of in 30 to 70? So no, not that not. The in would work on a list if you had a list of all the possible countries, and you wanted to say USA in that list. Okay, it has to be equal to one of the things. But no, there is no. All All right, so I'm gonna build a solution here. I'm gonna try to think out loud for people who didn't figure it out or people who were too tired, which is fine. So we want to mess around with the latitude and longitude. So we cleaned up that column. So I have all the latitudes here. For example, I'm just gonna do half of the work because I'm tired as well. That's not true. But, okay, so I have this latitude here. So now I want to compare. We have to start step by step. Okay, I want to compare the latitude, and I'm being told that if I am within 30 to 70, I am in Europe. Okay, so if I do latitude bigger than 30, it's going to tell me true or false. Okay, and so it's going to be one small component of my masking. Okay, I need to compare I need to make four comparisons and then combine them together. Okay, so I'm going to grab my latitude. I'm going to compare it to 30, and I'm going to do and grab my latitude again and compare it to 70 this time. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is to find all the countries that are going to satisfy. Oh, sorry, what am I doing here? Okay, so now I'm going to have a true and false. So now I have the right latitude range, but I don't quite have only the European countries because of the longitude. So I'm going to do the same for the longitude. By the way, did somebody try to do an ampersand in between these masks without the parentheses? Everybody, so there's the goal of this exercise is to learn that you have to put parentheses around your masks. If not, the ampersand takes precedence over the comparisons, and you end up with just a failure. Okay, you have to put parentheses around masks because of what ampersand is. Okay, so I'm gonna do now an ampersand. I'm gonna look at the longitude. I want the longitude to be bigger than minus 10. And I'm probably going to mess up because I'm on a small screen. What was the range for longitude? 40. All right, so cross your fingers. So now I have a mask, and it should tell me true only for European countries. Okay? How am I going to use that mask? I want to see all the countries. How am I going to use this mask? Okay, I am requesting some entries in this table. Okay, so it is an indexing operation. I know two indexing operators, lock and iloc. Okay, I'm going to use lock because I want to work with values, and so I'm going to use lock. But this is a useful mask. Where is this mask going to be used? As the rows, I like that idea. Okay, so I'm gonna do a dot lock. Oops, not here. I'm gonna do a dot lock. I need to define which rows do I want, which columns do I want. Okay, so the rows, that's exactly the mask. Okay, that has been filtering out all the things that I didn't want. Okay, so I want this mask for the rows, and then for the columns, I said I just want the country. Okay. I'm almost done. Who has done the bonus question of... So now I have the entire column of countries, but I have Great Britain multiple times. Who found a way to do the... how did you guys do it? Do a set. Very good. I love it. Very good. I love it too. And in fact, I think you can even do a unique like this. Oops. No. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so np.unique is going to be... It's going to save me a few characters then. Okay, so these are the European countries. Okay? Yes, sorry. So this cell is going to be comparing latitude and longitude for each of these things with an ampersand in between. And then I use that mask as my row filter. And then for the columns, I just wanted to know the countries. Okay? I'll post the notebooks again with the solution to the exercises. Okay? I'd like to make a very short interlude to warn you about something. It's related to this indexing operation. So I want to warn you about something important. And that warning is about, if you want to, so right now we've been just querying things, okay? If you ask for values, you can ask for values however you want. If you're trying to modify an object, modify a data frame, you have to be careful of the number of operations you use to access the value you want to modify, okay? Sometimes, so let me describe what I mean. If I have a data frame, GISS temp, here it is, I can grab one of the columns. Whenever I grab one of the columns, that's a series, okay? I know how to grab the first entry of a series, okay? And so I could be asking for the first entry of that series with a square bracket, and so I could be requesting that value, and that is fine. I've done a chained indexing operation, okay? I have two sets of square brackets, okay? The thing is, you have to know that in Python, everything gets evaluated from the left to the right, and so GISS temp of square bracket January gets evaluated first, and then a series ends up being created. And it's hard to know and to predict in pandas, not in NumPy, but in pandas, it's hard to know and to predict if a copy is going to be made or not, okay? And so whenever you are just requesting a value, it doesn't matter if a copy is made, unless you have a lot of data, now you have to worry about copies. But if you try to modify, what could happen in certain situations is that you're modifying this intermediate object and it doesn't modify the original object. Okay, so when you're trying to modify things, you never want to do multiple indexing like this. You always want to do it with these lock and ILOC operators. Okay, just a quick warning about that. So that would be a question for pandas core developers. What they have done, because they know it's complicated and they know it's almost impossible from a user point of view to predict what's going to happen, they have been emitting warnings whenever you do these chained indexing. They are warning you that it may not be doing what you want. Okay, so they'll try to detect that and do a warning message. But if you are aware of it and you avoid it, it's much better. And I'm running low on time, so I won't go into the details of the implementation. But basically, the data being stored behind a data frame is scattered into multiple arrays, and that's why it's hard to predict what's happening. It's because of pandas flexibility. I want to spend a few minutes working with dates and times, assuming that some of you are working on time series, and then we'll do a little bit of statistics with our data sets. All right, so our full globe temp, we've seen this weird NumPy jargon a few times now. So whenever we ask for the D type of a column or a series, and we get this this M8, NS means nanosecond. It's a datetime object. It's basically storing timestamps as integers in nanoseconds since epoch. Okay. The nice thing about having a real a datetime object for your index, for example, is that you can do operations on it. Okay. So that's the whole point. If, for example, you only wanted to know grab the data since, I don't know, Black Friday in 1929, for example, you could make a comparison of your index with this one time in history, okay? So that's the whole point of having time series. Now, whenever we look at our when we looked at our data set earlier, we had all of our, I don't have it here, and now I've just modified it. We had all of our values, here it was. We had all of our values on January 1st at midnight for each of the years. That was a little silly. We were creating more information that we had. When we loaded the file just said 1880, okay? It didn't say January 1st, 1880, okay? And that's because our file was describing a period in time, not a point in time, okay? And so by default, when you do a parse date, it's going to create a timestamp, a moment in time, and occasionally you're describing your values, and these values are describing a period of time, not a moment in time, okay? And so that's the difference in pandas between timestamps and periods, and so you can go back and forth between the two. Okay, so whenever you have an index, you can, or whenever you have a column that has dates in it, you can convert it back to a period, and which is what I just did right now. And now my series is going to look a lot more reasonable because those values had nothing to do with midnight of any day. Okay? If you want to convert them back, or if you were in a different situation, you can use two timestamps to go back to the original version that we had. Okay? Another thing you'll want to do, or you can want to do if you work with the dates and times and time series, is to resample them. Okay, that syntax has changed recently in pandas 0.17 or 0.18. So we used to be able to do a dot resample, and then we would specify whenever you do a resampling. So I had yearly data, for example. I'm just going to do one of those. I had yearly data. If I want to resample over 10 years, I can specify dot resample and then 10A. Okay, I've put here a little cheat sheet of the different string codes for the different durations that you may want to use. And A is going to be for annual or yearly. Okay, so you can resample your time series, and you can downsample your time series, or you can upsample your time series. Okay, so I had a yearly data set, so here I am going to downsample, so the dot mean doesn't mean much. But then if I do a downsampling of my data, now I have 10 values initially that need to be combined into one value, and so you can resample and combine these 10 values however you want. So it's now done in two different steps. You create a resampler object first with the dot resample, and you specify the frequency, and then you call dot mean on that object to calculate each values. Does that make sense? So I have averaged all my values over each decade, yes? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, can you tell me how? So look at what we have and tell me, or somebody else maybe can help. Phil, forward Phil. Very good. Phil NA. Phil NA with the forward Phil method. Yeah. Very good question. Awesome. All right. Another thing that you'll want to do if you work with time series is that sometimes you get your values and then people are calling you on the phone and saying, hey, by the way, these values correspond to daily values from that date to that date. Okay, and you're like, oh, great. Now I have to type in my index by hand. So you don't have to type in your index by hand if your index is regular enough, or is regular. Okay, so that's the point of this function called date range. Okay. So in that date range function, you can specify a start, a stop, and a frequency, or a start, a stop, and a number of values. Okay. So for example, with this date range, I'm going to create four daily values from January 1st, 1880 until January 4th, 1880, okay? So by default, if you don't specify a frequency, it's a daily frequency, okay? And these codes that I was mentioning earlier, they are going to work here as well. So frequency A is going to create a range of values since 1880 until 2016, and is going to be yearly. Okay? Notice here that I said yearly, and I end up with the end of the year. Okay, so everything ends up being indexed on December 31st of that year. Maybe you like it, or maybe you don't like it. If you don't like it, maybe it's good enough to go to a period range instead of a date range, okay? Another thing that you may not like, maybe you like the timestamp, but like maybe you like a financial quarterly results for a firm, for example. If that's the case, the date that is picked is actually the wrong date, but you still want a date. So there are all kinds of codes. I'm going to let you go back to the documentation if you want to do that. But you can specify, you can be very specific about your frequency. For example, instead of the beginning, the end of the year, if you wanted the start of the year, you could specify a frequency of AS, if I recall correctly. And now I have January 1st for all my timestamps instead of December 31st. Okay? So go back to the documentation and tweak it the way you want. You can do quarterly, you can do anything. Or you can here, yeah, I had it here below actually as a note. All right, and one of the indexes, I'm going to create one of them and I'll reuse it later. Actually, I'm almost running out of time, so I won't. But later in the notebook, this index would be reused. So I'm going to create some period range from 1880 to January of 2015. Sorry, December of 2015, using this period range instead of date range, okay? So that GISS temp, remember we had monthly data, but it was kind of weird because it has all the years in one direction and all the month in the other direction. That doesn't make any sense, okay? Really, it's just a time series. And so I'm gonna show you, or the notebook shows you later, how to just stack all the values to become one time series. I don't know if I'll be able to get to it, but that's what this index was for. Okay, I'm going to show you. I'll probably finish on that. I have 6 more minutes, so I'm going to finish on that. I want to show you precisely that stack and unstack, and I also want to show you there was a question here, for example, about how do you test. So, for example, earlier we tested whenever the latitude would be less than a certain value and more than a certain other value. Okay, but maybe sometimes you want to build a mask that's going to be more complicated than that, and you need to be able to apply a custom function to each of the values to make a certain test. Okay, one typical example of that is, let's say that I wanted all the entries for the countries being either being in a list of countries I'm interested in, maybe Mexico, Canada, and USA, for example, for Northern America. Okay, if I wanted to do this, I could do it with the ampersand, or I could build a little function that's going to test that my country name is in the list USA, Canada, and Mexico, and then apply that little function, that custom function, applied over all the values that I have, okay? So that's the point of this apply here, and it's the first one I want to show you. Okay, so the reason why I want to show you this is because if I look at the sea level stations, you see all these dates here? Let me show you real quick what this series looks like. It looks great at first, and then if you look at the D type of this, it's an object, okay? It's a string, meaning that if I am asking for the minimum value of that date or the maximum value of that date, it's going to be doing string comparison and it's going to give me the wrong date, okay? So that is something that I could have fixed when I loaded the file. by saying, I want you to parse this as a date, but I promised you that I would teach you how to do it after the fact. So I'm going to do it now. I'm going to grab this column, and I'm going to apply a function that takes a string, one string, and modifies it to make a date, a time object out of it. Do you know a function that does that? ToDateTime, very good. We just saw it earlier. Okay, ToDateTime does that. Thank you very much. And so I'm going to do that. I'm going to do a dot apply. I'm going to grab those dates. I'm going to do a dot apply and pass that function. The really nice, neat thing about this, and that's why you should feel powerful in 4 minutes when you walk out of here, is that you can pass in there a function that pandas define, but you can also pass in there a function that you defines, okay, def, and you take one value, you write your own function that does the completely custom thing, and you can transform any series into anything else. Okay, so I'm going to do that. And now, if I look at my series, it looks just the same, except that now my D type is date time. So now I do have real information. If I do a min or a max on that, I'm going to have some proper results. Okay? So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to use that operation, and I'm going to modify my date column with this with the result of this apply. All right. I'm going to... Do we want to finish with an exercise, or do we want to finish by me showing a little bit more of these transformation functions? I still have more transformations. Thank you. I needed an input. All right. So I'm going to show you how to sort your tables. So I apologize for not going further, but I wanted to go at a pace where everybody would follow the basics. And we've gone through that. So I'm going to finish with showing you how to sort your table. Okay, if we had to do this sorting with just NumPy arrays, again, it would be painful to have to keep track of all this bookkeeping that Pandas does for you. So here, just like with Excel, where you would click on a column and it would sort the whole table based on that one column, you can do this. And that's done with sort underscore values. And you can specify... in the by keyword argument, you can specify which column you want to sort your table by. Okay, so by default, it's sorted by the station name. I can decide that I want to sort by the date. And now my everybody is shuffled. You see all these numbers now are shuffled, but the dates are sorted. Okay. You can also sort by more than one column. You could say, I want to sort this table by the date column, and then for equal dates, I would like to sort it by country. Okay? And then you can even specify, there is another keyword argument called ascending. So you could say, actually, I want you to show me things in the reverse order. So now I'm going to have the newest date here on the top and the oldest date on the bottom. Okay? So stacking and unstacking. So I'll let you explore further by yourself. But this stacking and unstacking operation is what I described earlier. When you have a data frame and you want to stack all of your columns on top of each other, or potentially you want to stack all of your rows on top of each other, you can do that with these functions. Okay, there are many, many functions. There is no way to cover Pandas as a whole in 4 hours, but we've gone through the most important things. So thank you. Questions?